Troy there lies the sea. From isles of Greece, the princes Orgulus, their high blood chafed, have to the port of Athens sent their ships, fraught with the ministers and instruments of cruel war. 69, that wore their crownets regal, from the Athenian bay set forth toward Phrygia, and their vow is made to ransack Troy, within whose strong immures the ravished Helen, Menelaus' queen, with wanton Paris sleeps. And that's the quarrel. To Tenedos they come, and the deep-drawing bark do there disgorge their warlike fraughtage. Now on Dardan plains, the fresh and yet unbruised Greeks do pitch their brave pavilions. Priam's six-gated city, Dardan and Timbria, Ilius, Catus, Troian and Antinomides, with massy staples and corresponsive and fulfilling bolts, stir up the sons of Troy. Now expectation, tickling skittish spirits on one another side, Troian and Greek, sets all on hazard. And hither am I come, a prologue armed, but not in confidence of author's pen or actor's voice, but suited in like conditions as our argument, to tell you, fair beholders, that our play leaps o'er the vaunt and firstlings of those broils, beginning in the middle, starting thence away to what may be digested in a play. Like or find fault, do as your pleasures are. Now, good or bad, 'tis but the chance of war.
Call here my varlet. I'll unarm again. Why should I war without the walls of Troy that find such cruel battle here within? Each Troyan that is master of his heart, let him to field. Troilus, alas, hath none.
Will this gear ne'er be mended?
The Greeks are strong and skillful to their strength, fierce to their skill, and to their fierceness valiant. But I am weaker than a woman's tear, tamer than sleep, fonder than ignorance, less valiant than the virgin in the night, and skillless as unpracticed infancy.
But I have told you enough of this. For my part, I'll not meddle nor make further in the matter. He that will have a cake out of wheat must needs tarry the grinding.
Have I not tarried?
Aye, the grinding. But you must tarry the bolting.
Have I not tarried?
Aye, the bolting, but you must tarry the leavening.
Still have I tarried?
Aye, to the leavening. But here's yet in a word hereafter. The kneading, the making of the cake, the heating of the oven, and the baking. Nay, you must stay the cooling too, or you may chance to burn your lips.
Patience herself, what goddess e'er she be, doth lesser blench at sufferance than I do. At Priam's royal table do I sit, and when fair Cressid comes into my thought, so, traitor, when she comes, when is she thence?
Well, she looked yesternight fairer than ever I saw her look, or any woman else.
I was about to tell thee, when my heart, as wedged with a sigh, would rive in twain, lest Hector or my father should perceive me, I have, as when the sun doth light a storm, buried this sigh in wrinkle of a smile. But sorrow that is couched in seeming gladness is like that mirth fate turns to sudden sadness.
And her hair were not somewhat darker than Helen's? Well, go to. There were no more comparison between the women. But for my part, she is my kinswoman. I would not, as they term it, praise it, but I would someone had heard her talk yesterday as I did. Now I will not dispraise your sister Cassandra's wit.
Oh, but Pandarus, I tell thee, Pandarus, when I do tell thee, there my hopes lie drowned. Reply not in how many fathoms deep they lie entrenched. I tell thee, I am mad in Cressid's love. Thou answerest, she is fair. Pourest in the open ulcer of my heart, her eyes, her hair, her cheek, her gaze, her voice. And listen thy discourse. Oh, that her hand, in whose comparison all whites are inked, writing their own reproach, to whose soft seizure the sinew's down is harsh, and spirit of sense hard as the palm of ploughman. This thou tell'st me, as true thou tell'st me when I say I love her. But saying thus, instead of oil and balm, thou layest in every gash that love hath given me the knife that made it.
I speak no more than truth.
Thou dost not speak so much.
Oh, well, faith, I'll not meddle in it. Let her be what she is. If she be fair, 'tis the better for her. If she be not, she has the men's in her own hand.
Good Pandarus, how now, Pandarus?
I have my labor for my travail. Ill thought on of her, ill thought on of you. Gone between and between, but small thanks for my labor.
What? Art thou angry, Pandarus? What, with me?
Because she's kin to me, therefore she's not so fair as Helen, huh? And she were not kin to me, she would be as fair on Friday as Helen is on Sunday. But what care I, huh? I care not. And she were a blackamoor, 'tis all one to me.
Say I, she is not fair.
I do not care whether you do or no. She's a fool to stay behind her father. Let her to the Greeks. So I'll tell her the next time I see her. For my part, I am not meddle or make further in the matter.
Pandarus?
No, not I.
Sweet Pandarus.
You speak no more to me. I shall leave all as I found it, and there an end.
Peace, you ungracious Pandarus! Peace, rude sons! Fools on both sides, Helen must needs be fair when with your blood you dearly paint her thus. I cannot fight upon this argument. It is too starved a subject for my sword. But Pandarus, oh gods, how do you plague me? I cannot come to Crescent but by Pandar. And he's as tetchy to be wooed to woo as she is, stubborn, chaste against all suit. Tell me, Apollo, for thy Daphne's love, what Cressida is, what Pandar, and what we. Her bed is India. There she lies, a pearl. Between our Ilium and where she resides, let it be called a wild and wandering flood. Ourself, the merchant, and this sailing Pandar, our doubtful hope, our convoy, and our bark.
And now, Prince Troilus, wherefore not afield?
Because not there. This woman's answer sorts for woman as it is to be from thence. What news Aeneas from the field today?
Oh, that Paris is returned home and hurt.
By whom, Aeneas?
Troilus, by Menelaus.
Let Paris bleed, tis but a scarlet's corn. Paris is gored with Menelaus' horn.
Hark, what good sport is afield today?
Better at home, if would I might were made. But to the sport abroad, are you bound thither?
In all swift haste.
Come, go we then together.
Who are those went by?
Queen Hecuba and Helen.
And whither go they?
Up to the eastern tower, whose height commands a subject all the vale to see the battle.
Oh.
Hector, whose patience is as a virtue fixed, today was moved. He chid Andromache, struck his armor, and like as it were husbandry in war, before the sun rose he was harnessed light. And to the field goes he, where every flower did as a prophet weep what it foresaw in Hector's wrath.
What was his cause of anger?
The noise goes this. There is among the Greeks a lord of Trojan blood, nephew to Hector. They call him Ajax.
Good. What of him?
Well, they say he is a very man, per se, and stands alone.
So do all men, unless they are drunk, sick, or have no legs.
This man, lady, hath robbed many beasts of their particular additions. He is as valiant as the lion, as churlish as the bear, as slow as the elephant. A man to whom nature has so crowded humors that his valor is crushed into folly, his folly forced with discretion. There is not a man hath the virtue that he hath not a glimpse of, nor any man in a taint, but he carries some stain of it. He is melancholy without cause, and merry against the hair. He hath the joints of everything, but everything so out of joint, that he is a gouty Briareus, many hands and no use, or a purblind Argus, all eyes and no sight.
Well, how should this man that makes me smile make Hector angry?
They say he yesterday coped Hector in the battle. The shame and disdain of which hath ever since kept Hector fasting and waking.
Who comes here?
Madam, your uncle Pandarus.
Hector's a gallant man.
Who is maybe in the world, lady?
What's that? What's that?
Good morrow, Uncle Pandarus.
Good morrow, Cousin Cressida. What you talk of? Good morrow, Alexander.
How do you, cousin? When were you at Ilium?
This morning, uncle.
What were you talking of when I came? Was Hector armed and gone ere you came to Ilium? Helen was not up, was she?
Hector was gone, but Helen was not up.
Oh, you said Hector was stirring early.
That were we talking of, and of his anger.
Oh, was he angry?
So he says here.
Oh, it's true, so he was. I know the cause, too. He'll lay about him today, I can tell them that. And this Troilus will not come far behind him. Let them take heed of Troilus, I can tell them that, too.
What? Is he angry, too?
Who, Troilus? Troilus is the better man of the two.
Oh, Jupiter, there's no comparison.
What? Not between Troilus and Hector? Do you know a man if you see him?
Aye, if I ever saw him before and knew him.
Oh? Well, I say to you, Troilus is... Troilus.
Then you say as I say, for I'm sure he is not Hector.
No, not. And Hector is not Troilus in some degrees.
Tis just to each of them. He is himself.
Himself? Oh, alas, poor Troilus. Would he were himself.
So he is.
Condition I have gone barefoot to India.
But he is not Hector.
Himself? No, he is not himself. Would he were himself. Well, the gods are above. Time must friend or end. Oh, well, Troilus, well, I would my heart were in her body. No, Hector's not a better man than Troilus.
Excuse me.
Well, he is elder.
Pardon me.
The others not come to it yet. You shall tell me another tale when the others come to it. Hector shall not have his wit this year.
Will not need it if he have his own.
Not his qualities.
No matter.
Not his beauty.
Twould not become him. His own's better.
Oh, you have no judgment in this. Helen herself swore the other day that Troilus for a brown favor for, 'tis so I must confess. And yet, not brown neither.
No, but, brown.
Well, faith to say truth, brown and not brown.
To say the truth, true and not true.
Oh, well, she praised his complexion above Paris.
Why, Paris hath color enough?
Well, so he has.
Then Troilus should have too much. If she praised him above, his complexion is higher than his. He having color enough and the other higher is too flaming a praise for a good complexion. I had as lief Helen's golden tongue had commended Troilus for a copper nose.
Well, I swear to you, I think Helen loves him better than Paris.
Then she's a merry Greek indeed.
Nay, I am sure she does. Alexander. She came to him the other day into the coppiced window, and you know he has not passed three or four hairs on his chin.
Indeed, a tapster's arithmetic may soon bring his particulars therein to a total.
Why, he's very young, and yet he will, within 3 pounds, lift as much as his brother Hector.
Is he so young a man and so old a lifter?
Oh, but to prove to you that Helen loves Troilus, she came, and she puts me her white hand to his cloven chin.
Juno, have mercy! How came it cloven?
Why, you know, 'tis dimpled. Oh, I think his smiling becomes him better than any man in all Phrygia.
Oh, he smiles valiantly.
Oh, does he not?
Yes, and twere a cloud in autumn.
Why, go to. To prove to you that Helen loves Troilus.
Troilus will stand to the proof, if you'll prove it so.
Troilus? Why, he esteems her no more than I esteem an addled egg.
If you love an addled egg as well as you love an idle head, you would eat chickens in the shell.
I cannot choose but to laugh, to think how she tickled his chin. Indeed, she has a marvelous white hand, I must needs confess.
Without the rack?
And she takes it upon her to spy a white hair on his chin.
Alas, poor chin, many a wart is richer.
And there was such laughing! Queen Hecuba so laughed that her eyes ran off.
With millstones!
And Cassandra laughed.
Oh, but there was more temperate fire under the pot of her eyes. Did her eyes run o'er too?
And Hector laughed.
And what was all this laughing?
Mary, at the white hair that Helen spied on Troilus' chin.
And had been a green hair, I should have laughed too.
Well, they laughed not so much at the hair as at his pretty answer.
What was his answer?
Quoth she, here's but 52 hairs on your chin. And one of those hairs is white.
This is her question.
That's true. Now make no question on that. 52 hairs and one white, quoth he. Well, that white hair is my father, and all the rest are his sons.
Jupiter, quoth she, which one is Paris, my husband? The forked one, quoth he, pluck it out and give it to him. And there was such laughing, and Helen so blushed, and Paris so chafed, and all the rest so laughed that it passed.
So let it now, for it has been a great while going by.
Well, cousin, I told you a thing yesterday. Think on it.
So I do.
I'll be sworn, 'tis true. He will weep you, and 'twere a man born in April.
And I'll spring up in his tears, and 'twere a nettle against May.
Oh, hark! They are coming from the field. Oh, let us stand up here and watch them as they pass by to Ordelium. Oh, good niece, do, sweet niece, Cressida. Oh.
At your pleasure.
Here's an excellent place. Here we may see most bravely. I'll tell you them all by their names as they pass by. But mark Troilus above the rest.
Speak not so loud.
Oh, that's Aeneas. Is that not a brave man? Oh, he's one of the flowers of Troy, I can tell you. But mark Troilus, you shall see it on.
Who's that?
Oh, that's Antenor. There's a shrewd wit, I can tell you. Is a man good enough? One of the soundest judgments in Troy, whosoever, proper man at first. But when comes Troilus, I shall show you Troilus and on. Oh, if he see me, you shall see him nod at me.
Will he give you the nod?
You shall see.
If he do, the wretch shall have more.
Oh, that's Hector. Get that hold of you. Oh, that there's a fellow. Go thy way, Hector. There's a brave man. He's so brave, Hector. Look how he looks. There's a countenance. He's not brave now.
What brave man?
Oh, it's not. It does a man's heart good. Look you what hacks on his helmet. Look you there. Do you see? Look you yonder. Oh, there's no jesting. There's laying on. Take it off, who will, as the saying is. There be hacks.
See those with swords?
Swords, anything. He cares not. The devil come to him. It's all one. By God, that it does one's heart good. Oh, yonder comes Paris. Yonder comes Paris. Look you yonder, niece. Is this not Garrett? Is not? Why, this is brave now. Who said he came home hurt today? He's not hurt. Why, this will do Helen's heart good now. Oh, would I could see Troilus now. You shall see Troilus in arms.
Who is that?
Oh, that's Helenus. I marvel where Troilus is. That's Helenus. I think he went not forth today. Oh, that's Helenus.
Can Helenus fight, uncle?
Helenus, no. Oh, yes, he'll fight. Indifferent. Well, I marvel where Troilus is. Ha! Do you not hear the people cry, Troilus? Helenus is a priest.
What sneaking fellow comes yonder?
Where? Oh, yonder? Why, that's Theotibus. Oh, this Troilus! Oh, there's a man beast! Oh, brave Troilus! Prince of chivalry!
Peace for shame! Oh, peace!
Mark him, mark him! Oh, brave Troilus! Look well upon him, beast. See how his sword is bloodied, and how his helm more hacked than Hector's. Look how he looks, and how he goes. Oh, admirable youth! He ne'er saw 23. Oh, go thy way, Troilus, go thy way. Had I a sister, or a grace, or a daughter, a goddess, he should take his pick. Oh, admirable man, Paris is dirt to him. And I warrant you, Helen to change would give an eye to boot.
Here comes more.
Oh? Asses, fools, dunces, chatting down. For it's after meat. Why, to live and die in the eyes of Troilus. Oh, there, look. The eagles are gone, crows and daws. I had rather be such a man as Troilus than Agamemnon and all of Greece.
There is among the Greeks Achilles, a better man than Troilus.
Achilles? A drayman, a porter, a very camel.
Well.
Have you any discretion? Have you any eyes? Do you know what a man is? Is not birth, beauty, good shape, discourse, manhood, learning, gentleness, virtue, youth, liberality, and so forth, the spice and salt that seasons a man.
I, a minced man, and then to be baked with no date in the pie, for then the man's date's out.
You are such another woman. One knows not at what ward you lie.
Upon my back to defend my belly, upon my wit to defend my wiles, my secrecy to defend mine honesty, my mask to defend my beauty, and you to defend all these.
Oh.
And at all these wards I lie at a thousand watches.
Oh, say me one of your watches.
Hey, I'll watch you for that, and that's one of the cheapest of them, too. If I cannot ward what I would not have hit, I can watch you for telling how I took the blow.
Oh,
unless it's swell past hiding, then it's past watching.
Oh, you are such a mother.
Sir?
Yes?
My lord would instantly speak with you.
Where?
At your own house.
Good boy. Tell him I come. I doubt that he'd be hurt. Well, fare you well, niece.
At you, uncle.
Oh, I shall be with you, niece, by and by.
To bring, uncle?
Aye, a token from Troilus.
By the same token, you are a bawd. Words, vows, gifts, tears, and love's full sacrifice he offers in another's enterprise. But more in Troilus thousandfold I see than in a glass of Pandar's praise may be, yet hold I off. Women are angels wooing, things won not done. Joy so lies in the doing. That she beloved knows not that knows not this. Men prize the thing ungained more than it is. That she was never yet that ever knew love got so sweet as when desire did sue. Therefore this maxim out of love I teach. Achievement is command. Ungain, beseech. That though my heart's contents firm love doth bear, nothing of that shall from mine eyes appear.
Princes, what grief hath set the jaundice on your cheeks? The ample proposition that hope makes in all designs begun on earth below, fails in the promised largeness. Checks and disasters grow in the veins of action's highest reared, as knots, by the conflux of meeting sap, infect the sound pile, and divert his grain, tortive and errant, from his course of growth. No, princes, is it matter new to us that we come short of our suppose so far, that after 7 years' siege, yet Troy walls stand. Sith every action that hath gone before whereof we have record, trials did draw thwart and bias, not answering the aim, and that unbodied figure of the thought that gave it surmised shape. Why then, O you princes, do you with cheeks abash, behold our works and think them shame, which are indeed naught else but the protracted trials of great Jove, to find persistive constancy in men, the fineness of which metal is not found in fortune's love. For then, the hard and soft, the wise and fool, the bold and coward, the artist and unread, seem all affined and kin. But in the wind and tempest of her frown, distinction with a loud and powerful fan, puffing at all, winnows the light away, and what hath mass or matter by itself lies rich in virtue and unmingled.
With true observance of thy godlike secret, Agamemnon, Nestor shall apply thy latest words. In reproof of chance lies the true proof of men. The sea being smooth, how many shallow bubble boats dare sail upon her patient breast, making their way with those of nobler bulk? But let the ruffian Boreas once enrage the gentle Thetis, and anon behold the strong rib bulk through liquid mountains cut, pounding between the two moist elements like Perseus' horse. Where's then the saucy boat, whose weak untimbered sides, but even now co-rival greatness, either to harbor fled, or made a toast for Neptune? Now even so, does valor's worth and valor's show divide in storms of fortune? For in her ray and brightness, the sword hath more annoyance from the breeze than from the tiger. when the splitting wind makes flexible the knees of knotted oaks, and flies fled under shade, why then the thing of courage, as roused with rage doth sympathize, and with accent toned in self-same key, retorts to chiding fortune.
Agamemnon, thou great commander, nerve and bone of Greece, heart of our numbers, soul, and only spirit in whom the tempers and the minds of all should be shut up. Hear what Ulysses speaks, beside the applause and approbation, the which most mighty for thy place and sway, and thou most reverend for thy stretched out life, I give to both your speeches, which were such as Agamemnon and the hand of Greece should hold up high in brass, and such again as venerable Nestor, hatched in silver, should with a bond of air, strong as the axle tree on which the heavens ride, knit all Greeks' ears to his experienced tongue. Yet, let it please both, thou great and wise, to hear Ulysses speak.
Speak, Prince of Ithaca, and be it of less expect that matter needless of importless burden divide thy lips, then we are confident when rank Thersites opes his mastic jaws, we shall hear music, wit, and oracle.
Troy, yet upon his basis, had been down, and the great Hector's sword had lacked a master, but for these instances, the specialty of rule hath been neglected. And look, how many Grecian tents do stand hollow upon this plain, so many hollow factions. When that the general is not like the hive to whom the forager shall all repair, what honey is expected? Degree being visited, the unworthiest shows us fairly in the mask. The heavens themselves, the planets, and this center observe degree, priority, and place, incisure, course, proportion, season, form, office, and custom, in all line of order. And therefore is the glorious planet Sol in noble eminence enthroned, and sphered amidst the other, whose medicinable eye corrects the influence of planet's evil, and posts, like the commandment of a king, sans check to good and bad. But when the planets in evil mixture to disorder wander, what plagues and what portents, what mutiny, what raging of the sea, shaking of earth, commotion in the winds, frights, changes, horrors, divert and crack, rend and deracinate the unity and marriage calm of states quite from their fixture. Oh, when degree is shaped, which is the ladder to all high designs, the enterprise is sick. How could communities, degrees in schools, and brotherhoods in cities, the peaceful commerce from dividable shores, the primogenitive and due of birth, prerogative of age, crowns, scepters, laurels, but by degree stand in authentic place? Take but degree away, untune that string, and hark what discord follows. Each thing meets in mere repugnancy. The bounded waters should lift their bosoms higher than the shores and make a sop of all this solid globe. Strength should be lord of imbecility, and the rude son should strike his father dead. Force should be right, or rather right and wrong, between whose endless jar justice resides, should lose their names. And so should justice too. Then everything includes itself in power. Power into will. Will into appetite, and appetite, a universal wolf, so doubly seconded with will and power, must make perforce an universal prey, and last eat up himself. Great Agamemnon, this chaos, when degree is suffocate, follows the choking. And this neglection of degree is it, that by a pace goes backward, in a purpose it hath declined. The general's disdained by him one step below, he by the next, that next by him beneath. So every step, exampled by the first pace that is sick of his superior, grows to an envious fever of pale and bloodless emulation. And 'tis this fever that keeps Troy on foot, not her own sinews. To end a tale of length, Troy in our weakness lives, not in her strength.
Oh, most wisely had Ulysses here discovered the fever whereof all our power is sick.
The nature of the sickness found, Ulysses, what is the remedy?
The great Achilles, whom opinion crowns the sinew and the forehand of our host, having his ear full of his airy fame, grows dainty of his worth, and in his tent lies mocking our designs. With him Patroclus, upon a lazy bed, the livelong day breaks scurril jests. And with ridiculous and awkward action, which slanderer he imitation calls, he pageants us. Sometimes, great Agamemnon, thy topless deputation he puts on, and like a strutting player whose conceit lies in his hat and string, and who did think it rich to hear the wooden dialogue and sound twixt his stretched footing and the scaffoldage, such to be pitied and arrested seeming he acts thy greatness in. And when he speaks, 'tis like a chime amending, with terms unsquared that from the tongue of roaring Typhon dropped would seem hyperboles. At this fusty stuff, the large Achilles on his pressed bed lolling, from his deep chest laughs out a loud applause, cries, excellent, 'tis Agamemnon just. Now, plainly, Nestor, come and stroke thy beard, as he being dressed to some oration. That's done as near as the extremest ends of parallels, as like to Vulcan and his wife. Yet God Achilles still cries, excellent, 'tis Nestor right. Now play me, Patroclus, arming to answer in a night alarm. And then, forsooth, the faint defects of age must be the scene of mirth, to cough and spit, and with a palsy fumbling on his gorget, shake in and out the rivet. At this sport, Sir Valor dies, cries, oh, enough, Patroclus, or give me ribs of steel, I shall split all in pleasure of my spleen. And in this fashion, all our abilities, gifts, natures, shapes, severals and generals of grace exact, achievements, plots, orders, preventions, excitements to the field or speech for truce, success or loss, what is or is not, serves as stuff for these two to make paradoxes.
And in the imitation of these twain, whom, as Ulysses says, opinion crowns with an imperial voice, many are in fact. Ajax has grown self-willed, and bears his head in such a rage, in full as proud a place as broad Achilles, who keeps his tent like him, makes factious peace, and rails at our state of war bold as an oracle, and sets Thersites, a slave whose gold coin slanders like a mint, to match us in comparisons with dirt, weaken and discredit our exposure, how ranks however rounded in with danger.
They tax our policy, and call it cowardice. Count wisdom as no member of the war. Forestall prescience, and esteem no act but that of hand. The still and mental parts that do contrive how many hands shall strike when fitness hold them on. Or no, by measure of their observant toil, the enemy's weight, why, this hath not a finger's dignity. They call this bedwork, mappery, closet war. So that the ram that batters down the wall for the great swing and rudeness of his poise, they place before his hand that made the engine, or those that with the finest their souls by reason guide his execution.
Let this be granted, and Achilles' horse makes many feet a sum.
What trumpet? Look, Menelaus!
From Troy.
What would you for our tent?
Is this great Agamemnon's tent, I pray you?
Even this?
May one that is a herald and a prince do a fair message to his kingly ears.
With surety stronger than Achilles' arm, for all the Greekish heads, which with one voice call Agamemnon head and general.
Fair leave and large security. How may a stranger to those most imperial looks know them from the eyes of other mortals?
How?
I ask that I might wake in reverence, and on the cheek be ready with a blush, modest as morning when she coldly eyes the youthful Phoebus. Which is that god in office guiding men? Which is the high and mighty Agamemnon?
This Trojan scorns us, or the men of Troy are ceremonious courtiers.
Courtiers as free, as debonair, unarmed, as bending angels. That's their fame in peace. But when they would seem soldiers, they have galls, good arms, strong joints, true swords, and Jove's accord. Nothing so full of heart. But to peace, Aeneas, peace, Trojan, lay thy finger on thy lips. The worthiness of praise disdains his worth if that the praised himself bring the praise forth. But what the repining enemy commends, that breath fame blows, that praise soul pure transcends.
Sir, you of Troy, call you yourself Aeneas?
Aye, Greek, that is my name.
What's your affair, I pray you?
Sir, pardon, 'tis for Agamemnon's ears.
He hears not privately that comes from Troy.
Nor I from Troy come not to whisper him. I bring a trumpet to awake his sense, to set his ear on the attentive bent, and then to speak.
Speak frankly as the wind. It is not Agamemnon's sleeping hour. That thou shalt know, Troyan, he is awake. He tells thee so himself. Trumpet, blow!
Send thy brass voice through all these lazy tents. And every Greek of metal, let him know what Troy means fairly shall be spoke aloud.
We have, great Agamemnon, here in Troy, a prince called Hector. Priam is his father,
who in this dull and long-continued truce is rusty grown. He bade me take a trumpet and to this purpose speak. Kings, princes, lords, if there be one amongst the fairest of Greece that holds his honor higher than his ease, that seeks his praise more than he fears his peril, that knows his valor and knows not his fear, that loves his mistress more than in confession, with truant vows to her own lips he loves, and dare avow her beauty and her worth in other arms than hers, to him this challenge. Hector, in view of Trojans and of Greeks, shall make it good, or do his best to do it. He hath a lady, wiser, fairer, truer than ever Greek did compass in his arms, and will tomorrow with his trumpet call midway between your tents and walls of Troy to rouse a Grecian that is true in love. If any come, Hector shall honor him. If none, he'll say in Troy when he retires the Grecian dames are sunburnt and not worth the splinter of a lance.
Oh, even so much. This shall be told our lovers, Lord Aeneas. If none of them have soul in such a kind, we left them all at home. But we are soldiers, and may that soldier a mere recreant prove, that means not, hath not, or is not in love. If then, one is, or hath, or means to be, that one meets Hector. If none else, I'll be he.
Oh, tell him of Nestor, one that was a man when Hector's grandsire sucked. Oh, he's old now. But if there be not in our Grecian mold one noble man who hath one spark of fire in him to answer for his love, well, you tell him from me that I'll hide this silver beard in a gold beaver, and in my bad breath put this withered brawn, and meeting him will tell him that my lady was fairer than his grandam, and as chaste as may be in the world. His youth in flood, I'll prove this truth with my 3 drops of blood.
Now, heaven forbid such scarcity of youth.
Amen.
Fair Lord Aeneas, let me touch your hand. To our pavilion shall I lead you first. Achilles shall have word of this intent. So shall each lord of Greece from tent to tent. Yourself shall feast with us before you go, and find the welcome of a noble foe.
Nestor.
What said Ulysses?
I have a young conception in my brain. Be you my time to bring it to some shape?
What is?
This is. Blunt wedges rive hard nuts. The seeded pride that hath to this maturity blown up in rank Achilles must or now be cropped or shedding breed a nursery of like evil to overbulk us all.
Well, and how?
This challenge that the gallant Hector sends, however it is spread in general name, relates in purpose only to Achilles. Ooh.
The purpose is perspicuous, even as substance, whose grossness little characters sum up. And in the publication make no strain, but that Achilles were his brain as barren as the banks of Libya. Though Apollo knows 'tis dry enough. Will with great speed of judgment, high with celerity, find Hector's purpose pointing on him.
And wake him to the answer, think you?
Yes. Tis most meet. Who may you else suppose that can from Hector bring his honor off, if not Achilles? Though it be sportful combat,
yet in this trial much opinion dwells. For here the Trojans taste our disrepute with their pints palate. Trust in Ulysses, our imputation shall be oddly poised in this wild action. For the success, although particular, shall give a scantling of good or bad unto the general. And in such indexes, although small pricks to the subsequent volumes, there is seen the baby figure of a giant mass of things to come at large. Look, it is thought that he that meets Hector issues from our choice, and choice being mutual act of all our souls, makes merit her election, and doth boil, as 'twere, from forth us all, a man distilled out of our virtues. Who miscarrying? Well, what heart from hence receives the conquering part to steal a strong opinion to themselves? Which entertained, limbs are his instruments, and no less working than are swords and bows directed by the limbs.
Give pardon to my speech. Therefore, 'tis meet Achilles meet not Hector. Let us, like merchants, show our foulest wares and think perchance they'll sell. If not, the luster of the better yet to show shall show the better. Do not consent that ever Hector and Achilles meet. For both our honor and our shame in this are dogged with two strange followers.
I see them not with my old eyes. What are they?
What glory our Achilles shares from Hector, were he not proud, we all should wear with him. But he already is too insolent. And we were better parch in Afric's sun than in the pride and salt scorn of his eyes should he scape Hector fair. If he were foiled, why then we did our main opinion crush in taint of our best man. No. Make a lottery, and by device, let blockish Ajax draw the sort to fight with Hector. Among ourselves, give him allowance as the worthier man, for that will physic the great Myrmidon who broils in loud applause, and make him fall his crest that prouder than blue iris bends. If the dull brainless Ajax come safe off, we'll dress him up in voices. If he fail, yet go we under our opinion still that we have better men. But hit or miss, our project's life this shape of sense assumes. Ajax employed plucks down Achilles' plume.
Oh, now, Ulysses, I begin to relish thy advice, and will give a taste of it forthwith to Agamemnon. Go we to him straight. Two curs shall tame each other. But pride alone must tear the mastiff's arm. Just where they're bone.
Ascites!
Agamemnon. How be at boils? Foot all over, generally.
Ascites!
These boils did run. Say so. Did not the general run then? Were not that a bocce call?
Dog!
Then would come some matter from him. I see none
now.
Now,
pitiful son! Canst thou not hear?
Mongrel beef-witted lord.
Speak then, thou vine-wet sloven, speak! I'll beat thee into handsomeness.
I will sooner rail thee into wit and holiness, though I think thy horse can sooner con an oration than thou learn a prayer without book. Thou canst strike, canst thou, a red murrain of thy jade's tricks.
Toadstool! Learn me the proclamation.
Thou think I have no sense, thou strikest me thus.
The proclamation?
Thou art proclaimed a fool, I think.
Oh, do not, Porpentine, do not. My fingers itch.
I would thou did itch from head to foot, and I had the scratching of thee. I would make thee the loathsome a scab in Greece. When thou art forth in the incursions, thou strikest as slow as another.
I say the proclamation.
Thou grumblest and railest every hour on Achilles, and thou art more full of envy at his greatness than Cerberus is of Proserpina's beauty. Aye, that thou barkest at him.
Mistress Thersites.
Thou should strike him.
Cob loaf.
He would punt thee in the shivers with his fist like a sailor breaks a biscuit.
You horse and cur.
Do.
Thou stool for a witch.
I do, thou sodden witted lord. Thou hast no more brain than I have in mine elbows. An Asinico may tutor thee, thou scurvy valiant ass. Thou art here but to thrash Troians, and thou art bought and sold among those that are oppressed like a barbarian slave. If you use to beat me, I will begin at thy heels and tell what thou art by inches, thou thing of no bowels, thou.
Dog! Scowl, thou cur!
Mars is idiot. Oh, do rudeness. Do, camel. Do, do.
How now, Ajax? Wherefore do you this?
How now, Thersites? What's the matter, man?
You see him there, do you?
Aye. What's the matter?
But look on him.
Well, I do so. What's the matter?
But regard him well.
Well? Why, I do so. What
but
is
you
the...
You look not well enough upon him. Or whosomever you may take him to be. He is Ajax.
I know that fool.
Aye, but that fool knows not himself.
Therefore I beat thee.
Oh, lo, what modicums of wit he utters. His evasions have ears thus long. I have bobbed his brain more than he's beat my bones. I will buy 9 sparrows for a penny, and his pia mater is not worth 1/9 part of a sparrow. This morning, please, Ajax, who wears his wit in his belly and his guts in his head. I'll tell you what I say of him.
What?
I say, this Ajax...
Oh, nay, good Ajax.
Hath not so much wit.
Nay, I must hold you.
But stop the eye of Helen's needle for whom he comes to fight.
Oh, that damn cunt! Will you set your wit to a fool?
No, I warrant you, for a fool's will shame it.
Oh, good words, Thersites.
What's the quarrel?
I bade thee, vile owl, to go learn me the tenor of the proclamation, and he rails upon me.
I serve thee not.
Well, go to,
I
go to.
I serve thee voluntary.
Your last service was sufferance. 'Twas not voluntary. No man is beaten voluntary. Ajax was here the voluntary, and you, as under an impress.
Even so, a great deal of your wit, too, lies in your sinews, or else there be liars. Oh, Hector will have a great catch if he knocks out either of your brains. You were as good crack of fusty nut with no kernel.
What, with me too?
Here's Ulysses, an old Nestor, whose wit was moldier. Your grandsires had nails on their toes. They yoke you like draft oxen and make you plow up the wall.
What?
Good suit, 2 Achilles, 2 Ajax, 2,
I shall cut out your tongue!
So, remember, I shall speak more than thee after.
No more words, Thersites.
Shall hold my peace when Achilles brought bids me, shall I?
That's for you, Patroclus.
I will see thee all hang like knotholes that I come any more to your tents. I'll keep with his wit setting and leave the faction of fools.
Mary, this, is proclaimed through all our host, that Hector, by the 5th hour of the sun, will, with a trumpet twixt our tents and Troy, tomorrow morning, call some knight to arms. And such a one as dare maintain... I know not what. She's trash. Farewell.
Farewell.
Who shall answer him? I know not. Tis put to lottery. Otherwise, he knew his man.
Ah, meaning you. But I'll go learn more.
After so many hours, lives, speeches spent, thus once again says Nestor from the Greeks, deliver Helen, and all damage else, as honor, loss of time, travail, expense, wounds, friends, and what else dear that is consumed in hot digestion of this cormorant war shall be struck off. Hector, what say you to it?
Though no man lesser fears the Greeks than I, as far as touches my particular. Yet, dread Priam, there is no lady of more softer bowels, more spongy to suck in the sense of fear, more ready to cry out, who knows what follows, than Hector is. The wound of peace is surety, surety secure. But modest doubt is called the beacon of the wise, the tent that searches to the bottom of the worst. Let Helen go.
Oh.
Since the first sword was drawn about this question, every tithe soul amongst many thousand dimes hath been as dear as Helen. I mean of ours. If we have lost so many tenths of ours to guard a thing not ours nor worth to us, had it our name, the value of one tenth, what merits in that reason which denies the yielding of her up?
Fie, my brother! Weigh you the worth and honor of a king so great as our dread father in a scale of common ounces? Will you with counters sum the past proportion of his infinite, and buckle in a waist most fathomless with spans and inches so diminutive as fears and reasons? Fie for godly shame!
No marvel, though you bite so sharp at reason, you are so empty of them. Should not our father bear the great sway of his affairs with reasons, though your speech hath none that tells him so?
You are for dreams and slumbers, brother priest. You fare your gloves with reason. Here are your reasons. You know an enemy intends you harm. You know a sword employed is perilous, and reason flies the object of all harm. Who marvels then, when Helenus beholds a Grecian and his sword, if he do set the very wings of reason to his heels and fly like chidden Mercury from Jove, or like a star dissolved? Nay, if we talk of reason, let's shut our gates and sleep. Manhood and honor should have hare hearts, were they but fat their thoughts with this crammed raisin. Reason and respect make livers pale and lustihood deject.
Brother, she's not worth what she doth cost the keeping.
What's aught but as 'tis valued?
But value dwells not in particular will. It holds its estimate and dignity as well, wherein 'tis precious of itself as in the prizer. 'Tis mad idolatry to make the service greater than the god. And the will dotes, that is inclinable to what infectiously itself affects, without some image of the affected merit.
I take today a wife, and my election is led on in the conduct of my will enkindled by my eyes and ears, two traded pilots twixt the dangerous shores of will and judgment. How may I avoid, although my will distaste what it elected, the wife I chose? There can be no evasion to blench from this and to stand firm by honor. We turn not back the silks upon the merchant when we have soiled them. Nor the remainder viands we do not throw an unrespective sieve, because we now are full. It was thought meet Paris should do some vengeance on the Greeks. Your breath of full consent bellied his sails. The seas and winds, old wranglers, took a truce and did him service. He touched the ports desired, and for an old aunt whom the Greeks held captive, he brought a Grecian queen, whose youth and freshness wrinkle Apollo's and make stale the morning. Why keep we her? The Grecians keep our aunt. Is she worth the keeping? Why, she is a pearl whose price hath launched above 1,000 ships and turned crown kings to merchants. If you'll avouch 'twas wisdom Paris went, as you must needs, for you all cried, go, go. If you'll confess he brought home noble prize, as you must needs, for you all clapped your hands and cried, inestimable, why do you now the issue of your proper wisdom's rate, and do a deed that fortune never did? Beggar the estimation which you prized richer than sea and land. Oh, theft most base, that we have stolen what we do fear to keep. But thieves, unworthy of a thing so stolen, that in their country did them that disgrace, we fear to warrant in our native place.
Cry, Troyans, cry!
Troyans, what shriek is that? He's our mad sister, I know her voice.
Cry! Cry, Troyans! Cry, Troyans, cry! Lend me 10,000 eyes, and I will fill them with prophetic tears!
Peace, sister, peace!
Virgins and boys, mid-age and wrinkled old, soft infancy, that nothing can but cry, add to my clamors! Let us pay betime a moiety of that mass of moan to come. Cry, Troyans, cry. Practice
strains of divination in our sister work some touches of remorse? Or is your blood so madly hot that no discourse of reason nor fear of bad success in a bad cause can qualify the same?
Why, Brother Hector, we may not think the justice of each act such and no other than event to form it, nor once deject the courage of our minds because Cassandra's mad. Her brain-sick raptures cannot distaste the goodness of a quarrel which hath our several honors all engaged to make it gracious. For my private part, I am no more touched than all Priam's sons, and Jove forbid there should be done amongst us such things as might offend the weakest spleen to fight for and maintain.
Else might the world convince of levity, as well my undertakings as your counsels. But I attest the gods, your full consent gave wings to my propension, and cut off all fears attending on so dire a project. But what, alas, can these, my single arms? What propagation is in one man's valor to stand the push and enmity of those this quarrel would excite? As I protest, were I alone to pass the difficulty, and had as ample power as I have will, Terra should ne'er retract what he hath done, nor faint in the pursuit.
Paris, you speak like one besotted on your sweet delights. You have the honey still, but these the gall. So to be valiant is no praise at all.
Sir, I propose not merely to myself the pleasure such a beauty brings with it, but I would have the soil of her fair rape wiped off in honorable keeping of her. What treason were it to the ransacked queen? Disgrace to your great work, and shame to me. Now to deliver her possession up on terms of base compulsion. Can it be that so degenerate a strain as this should once set footing in your generous bosom? There's not the meanest spirit in our party without heart to dare or sword to draw when Helen is defended. Nor none so noble, whose life were ill bestowed or death unfeigned, where Helen is the subject. Then I say, well may we fight for her, whom we know well the world's large spaces cannot parallel.
Paris and Troilus, you both said well. And on the cause in question here at hand, it glows but superficially, not much unlike young men whom Aristotle thought unfit to hear moral philosophy. The reasons you allege, you more conduce to the hot passion of distempered blood and to make up a free determination twixt right and wrong. For pleasure and revenge have ears more deaf than adders to the voice of any true decision. Nature craves all dues be rendered to their owners. Now, what nearer debt in all humanity than wife is to the husband? If this law of nature be corrupted through affection, and that great minds of partial indulgence to their benumbed wills resist the same, there is a law of each well-ordered nation to curb those raging appetites that are most disobedient and refractory. If Helen, then, be wife to Sparta's king, as it is known she is, then to persist in doing wrong extenuates not that wrong, but makes it much more heavy. Hector's opinion is this, in way of truth. Yet, nevertheless, my sprightly brethren, I propend to you in resolution to keep Helen still, for 'tis a cause that hath no mean dependence upon our joint and several dignities.
Why, there you touch the life of our design. Were it not glory that we more affected than the performance of our heaving spleens, I would not wish a drop of Trojan blood spent more in her defense. But worthy Hector, she is a theme of honor and renown, a spur to valiant and magnanimous deeds, whose present courage may beat down our foes and fain in time to come canonize us. For I presume brave Hector would not lose so rich advantage of a promised glory as smiles upon the forehead of this action for the wide world's revenue.
I am yours, you valiant offspring of great Priamus. I have a roisting challenge sent among the dull and factious nobles of the Greeks will strike amazement to their drowsy spirits. I was advertised their great general slept, whilst emulation in the army crept. This, I presume, will wake him.
How now, Thucydides? Got lost in the the labyrinth of thy fury, shall the elephant Ajax carry it thus? He beats me, and I rail at him, oh, worthy satisfaction. But it were otherwise, that I could beat him whilst he railed at me, scut, I'll learn to conjure and raise devils, but I'll see some issue of my spiteful execrations. Then there's Achilles, a rare engineer. If Troy be not taken till these two undermine it, the walls will stand till they fall of themselves. Oh, thou great thunder daughter of Olympus, forget that thou art Jove, the king of gods, and Mercury, lose all the serpentine craft of thy caduceus if you take not that little less than little wit from them that they have. Which, short-armed ignorance itself knows is so abundant scarce, it will not in circumvention deliver a fly from a spider without drawing the massy irons and cutting the web. After this, the vengeance on the whole camp, or rather, the Neapolitan bone ache. For that, methinks, is the curse dependent on those at war for a placket.
What oath? My lord Achilles!
Who's that? Thersites! Good Thersites! Come in and rail.
If I could have remembered a gilt counterfeit, thou wouldst not have slipped out of my contemplation. But 'tis no matter, thyself upon thyself. The common curse of mankind, folly and ignorance, be thine in great revenue. Heaven bless thee from a tutor, and discipline come not near thee. Let thy blood be thy direction till thy death. And then, if she that lays thee out says thou art a fair course, I'll be sworn and sworn upon it she never shrouded any but Lazars. Where's Achilles?
What, art thou devout? Wast thou in a prayer?
Aye, the heavens hear me. Amen.
Who's there?
Thersites, my lord.
Where? Art thou come? Why, my geez, my digestion. Why hast thou not served thyself into my table so many meals? Come, what's Agamemnon?
Thy commander, Achilles. And tell me, Patroclus, what's Achilles?
Thy lord, Thersites. Then tell me, I pray thee, what's thyself?
I know her, Patroclus. Then tell me, Patroclus, what art thou?
Oh, thou mayest tell that knowest.
I'll tell?
I'll decline the whole question.
Tell.
Agamemnon commands Achilles. Achilles is my lord. I am Patroclus Nor, and Patroclus is a fool.
He's a privileged man. Proceed, Thersites.
Agamemnon is a fool, Achilles is a fool, Thersites is a fool, and as aforesaid, Patroclus is a fool.
Derive this, come.
Agamemnon is a fool to offer to command Achilles. Achilles is a fool to be commanded of Agamemnon. Thersites is a fool to serve such a fool, and Patroclus is a fool positive.
Why am I a fool?
Make that demand of the creator, it suffices me thou art. Look you, who comes here?
Patroclus, I'll speak with nobody. Come in with me, Thersites.
It is such knavery, such juggling, and such patchery. The whole argument is a cuckold and a whore. A good quarrel to draw emulation. Factions and bleed to death upon. Now the dry serpigo on the whole subject. And war and lechery, confound all.
Where is Achilles?
Within his tent, but ill disposed, my lord.
Let it be known that we are here. He sent our messengers, and we lay by our appertainments, visiting of him. Let him be told so, lest perchance he think we dare not move the question of our place, nor know not what we are.
I shall so say to him.
We saw him at the opening of his tent. He is not sick.
Yes, sick. Lion sick. Sick of proud heart. You may call it melancholy if you favor the man.
But by my head it is pride.
But why? Why? Let him show us cause. A word, my lord.
What moves Ajax thus to bear at him?
Achilles has inveigled his fool from him.
Oh, Thersites?
He.
Then will Ajax lack matter if he have lost his argument?
No, you see, he is his argument that has his argument. Achilles.
All the better. Their fraction is more our wish than their faction. But it was a strong composure that a fool could dish unite.
The amity that wisdom didst not, folly may easily untie.
Here comes Patroclus.
No Achilles with him.
Well, the elephant has joints, but none for courtesy. His legs are legs for necessity, not for flexure.
Achilles bids me say he is much sorry if anything more than your sport and pleasure did move your greatness. And this noble state to call upon him. He hopes it is no other but for your health and your digestion's sake. And after dinner's bread.
Hear you, Patroclus. We are too well acquainted with these answers. But his evasion, winged thus swift with scorn, cannot outfly our apprehensions. Much attribute he hath. And much the reason why we ascribe it to him. Yet all his virtues, not virtuously of his own part beheld, do in our eyes begin to lose their gloss. Yea, and like fair fruit in an unwholesome dish, are like to rot untasted. Go and tell him we came to speak with him, and you shall not sin. If you do say, we think him overproud and under-honest, in self-assumption greater than in the note of judgment, and worthier than himself, he attend the savage strangeness he puts on, disguise the holy strength of their command, and underwrite in an observing kind his humorous predominance. Go and tell him this, and you can add that if he overhold his price so much, will none of him, but let him lie like an engine not portable under this report. Bring action hither. This cannot go to war. A stirring dwarf do we allowance give before a sleeping giant. Go tell him so.
I shall, and bring his answer presently.
In second voice we'll not be satisfied. We came to speak with him. Ulysses, enter you.
What is he more than another?
No more than what he thinks he is.
Is he so much? Do you not think he thinks himself a better man than I am?
No question.
Will you subscribe his thought and say he is?
No, Ajax. You are as strong, as valiant, as wise, no less noble, much more gentle, and altogether more tractable.
Why should a man be proud? How doth pride grow? I know not what it is.
Oh, your mind is the clearer, Ajax. Your virtues the fairer. He that is proud eats up himself. His own pride is his own glass, his own chronicle, his own trumpet. Whatever praises itself but in the deed, devours the deed in the prey.
I do hate a proud man as I hate the engendering of toads.
And yet he loves himself. Is it not strange?
Achilles will not to the field tomorrow.
What's his excuse?
He doth rely on none, but carries on the stream of his dispose, without observance or respect of any, in will peculiar and in self-admission.
Why, will he not upon our fair request untent his person and share the air with us?
Oh, things small as nothing for request's sake only. He makes important. Possessed he is with greatness, and speaks not to himself, but with a pride that quarrels at self-breath. Imagined worth holds in his blood such swollen and hot discourse that twixt his mental and his active parts, kingdomed Achilles in commotion rages and batters against himself. What shall I say? You're so plaguey proud that the death tokens of it cry no recovery.
Let Ajax go to him. Dear Lord, go you and greet him in his tent. 'Tis said he holds you well, and will be led a little at your request from himself.
Oh, Agamemnon, let it not be so. We'll consecrate the steps that Ajax makes when they go from Achilles. Shall the proud lord that bastes his arrogance with his own seam and never suffers matter of the world enter his thoughts, save such as doth revolve and ruminate himself, shall he be worshipped? Of that we hold an idol more than he? No! This thrice worthy and right valiant lord must not so stale his palm, nobly acquired, nor by my will subjugate his merit, as amply titled as Achilles is, by going to Achilles. That were to enlarge his fat already pride, and add more coals to Cancer when he burns with entertaining great Hyperion. This lord go to him, Jupiter forbid. Say in thunder, Achilles, go to him.
Oh, this is well. He rubs the vein of him.
And how his silence drinks up this applause.
If I go to him with my armed fist, I'll pass him all the face.
Oh, no, you shall not go.
And end of it proud with me.
I'll face his pride. Let me go to him.
No, for the words that hangs upon our quarrel.
Paltry, insolent fellow.
Oh, how he describes himself.
Can he not be sociable?
The raven chides blackness.
Hell, that is humus blood.
He will be the physician that should be the patient.
And all men were of my mind.
Which would be out of fashion.
He should not bear it so. He should eat swords first. Shall pride carry it?
Wouldn't carry half.
I would have 10 shares.
I'll meet him. I'll make him supple.
He is not yet warm. Force him with praises. Pour in, pour in. His ambition is dry.
My lord, you feed too much on this dislike.
Oh, our noble general, you should not do so.
You must prepare to fight without Achilles.
Why, 'tis this naming of him does him harm. Now, here's a man, but 'tis before his face I will be silent.
Well, now, wherefore should you so? He is not emulous as Achilles is.
Well, know the whole world he is as valiant.
The horse and dog that will falter thus with us. Would he were a Trojan.
What a vice it were in Ajax now, whether...
If he were proud.
Or covetous of prey.
Aye, or surly born.
Or strange, or self-affected.
No, thank the heavens, Lord, thou art of sweet composure. Praise him that got thee, she that gave thee suck. Famed be thy tutor. And thy parts of nature thrice famed beyond all erudition. But he that disciplined thy arms to fight, let Mars divide eternity in twain and give him half. And for thy vigor, bull-bearing Milo his addition yield to sinewy Ajax. I will not praise thy wisdom, which like a born, pale, sure confines thy spacious and dilated parts. Oh, here's Nestor. Instructed by the antiquary times, he must, he is, he cannot but be wise. But, pardon, Father Nestor, were your days as green as Ajax, and your brain so tempered, you would not have the eminence of him, but be as Ajax.
May I call you Father?
Aye, my good son.
Be ruled by him, Lord Ajax.
There is no tarrying here. The hard Achilles keeps thicket. Please it our great general to call together all his staff of war. Fresh kings are come to Troy. Tomorrow we must with all our main of power stand fast. And here's a knight. Come knights from east to west and cull their flower. Ajax shall cope the best.
Go we to council. Let Achilles sleep.
Light boat sailed swift, the greater boat draw deep.
Oh, friend, you pray you a word. Do you not follow the young Lord Paris?
Aye, sir, when he goes before me.
You depend upon him, I mean.
Sir, I do depend upon the Lord.
Ah, well, you depend upon a noble gentleman. I must needs praise him.
The Lord be praised.
You know me, do you not, friend?
Superficially, sir.
Well, friend, know me better. I am the Lord Pandarus.
Oh, I hope to know your honor better.
Yes, I do desire it.
You are in a state of grace, sir.
Grace? Not so, friend. Honor and lordship are my title. What music is this?
I do but partly know, sir. It is music in part.
Know you the musicians?
Holy, sir.
Who play they to?
To the hearers, sir.
At whose pleasure, friend?
At mine, sir, and theirs that love music.
Command, I mean, friend.
Who shall I command, sir?
We understand not one another, friend. I am too courtly and thou art too cunning. At whose request do these men play?
Marry, sir, that's true indeed, sir. At the request of Paris, my lord, who's there in person? With him, the mortal Venus, the heart blood of beauty, love's invisible soul.
Who, my cousin, Cressida?
Oh, no, sir, Helen. Could not you find that out by her attributes?
It should seem, fellow, that thou hast not seen the Lady Cressida. I come to speak to Paris from the Prince Troilus. I will make a complimentary assault upon him for my business seethes.
Sodden business, there's a stewed phrase indeed.
Fair be to you, my lord, and to all this fair company, fair desires,
in all fair measure, fairly guide them, especially to you, fair queen. Fair thoughts, be your fair pillow.
Dear Lord, you're full of fair words.
Oh, well, now you speak your fair pleasure, sweet queen. Fair prince, here is good broken music, huh?
You have broke it, cousin. And by my life, you shall make it whole again.
Oh.
You shall piece it out with a piece of your performance. Nelly's full of harmony.
Truly, lady, no.
Oh, sir.
Rude in sooth, in good sooth, very rude.
Well said, lord. Well, you say so and fit.
I have business to my lord, sweet queen. My lord, you vouchsafe me a word.
Nay, this shall not fetch us out. We'll hear you sing, certainly.
You are pleasant with me, sweet queen. But, well done, my lord. My dear lord, most esteemed friend, your
brother. My lord! Honey, sweet lord.
Go to, sweet queen, go to. Commend himself most affectionately to say that...
Nay, you shall not bob us out of our melody. If you do, our melancholy upon your head.
Oh, sweet queen, sweet queen. Now that's a sweet queen in faith, huh?
And to make a sweet lady sad. It's a sour offense.
Nay, now that shall not serve your turn. That shall it not in truth. La. Nay, I care not for such words. No, no, no. And
my lord, Pandarus!
What then, my sweet queen? My very, very sweet queen.
What exploits an hammer sups he tonight?
Nay, but my lord!
What then, my sweet queen? My cousin will fall out. You must not know him.
With my disposer, Cressida.
No, 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 no such matter. Come, your wife, your disposer's sick.
I'll make excuse.
Aye, good my lord. Why should you say Cressida, huh? No, your poor disposer's sick.
I spy.
You spy? What do you spy? Come, give me an instrument, sweet queen.
Oh, why, this is kindly done.
Oh, my niece is horribly in love with the thing you have, sweet queen.
But she should have it, my lord. It would not be my lord Paris.
He? Oh, she'll none of him. They two are twain.
Falling in after falling out may make them three.
I hear no more of this. I want to sing your song.
I prithee now. Oh, by my troth, sweet lord, thou hast a fine forehead.
You may.
Let thy song be love. This love will undo us all. Oh, Cupid.
Love, aye, that it shall in faith.
Aye, good now, love. Love, nothing but love.
In good troth, it begins so. Oh, dear. Oh, well. Love, love, nothing but love still more. For oh, love's bow shoots buck and doe. The shaft confounds, not that it wounds, but tickles still the sore. These lovers cry, oh, they die. Yet that which seems the wound to kill doth turn, oh, to happy, so dying love lives still. Oh, 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 while but ha, 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 oh, oh, groans out for ha, ha, ha.
But doves love, and that breeds hot blood. And hot blood begets hot thoughts, and hot thoughts beget hot deeds.
Why?
Hot deeds as love.
Is this the generation of love? Hot blood, hot thoughts, hot deeds. Why, they are vipers. Is love the generation of vipers? Sweet lord, who's afield today?
Hector, Deiphobus, Helenus, Antenor, and all the gallantry of Troy.
I would fain have armed today. My Nell would not have it so. I'll chance my brother Troilus went not.
He hangs a lip at something.
Oh?
You know all, Lord Pandarus.
Oh, not I, my honey sweet queen. I long to hear how they sped. You remember your brother's excuse, but...
Who am I?
Farewell, sweet queen.
Commend me to your niece.
Oh, that I shall, sweet queen.
I come from Thea. Let's to Priam's hall to greet the warrior. Sweet Helen, I must woo you to help unarm our Hector. His stubborn buckles with these your white enchanting fingers cuts shall morrow bathe into wedge of steel or course of freaky sinew. You shall do more than all the island kings. Disarm great Hector.
Oh, it shall make us proud to be his servant, Paris. Yea, what he shall receive of us in duty gives us more palm in beauty than we have, yea, or shines ourselves.
Sweet above thought, I love thee.
Oh, how now, how now? Here's thy master at my cousin Cressida's.
No, sir, he stays for you to conduct him thither.
Oh, here he comes, here he comes. How now, how now?
Sit up, walk off.
Have you seen my cousin?
No, Pandarus, I stalk about a door like a strange soul upon the Stygian bank staying for waftage. Oh, be thou my Cairn, and give me swift transportance to those fields where I may wallow in the lily beds proposed for the deserver. Oh, gentle Pandarus, from Cupid's shoulder pluck his painted wings and fly with me to Cressida.
Walk here in the orchard. I'll bring her straight.
I'm giddy. Expectation whirls me round. The imaginary relish is so sweet that it enchants my sense. What will it be when that the watery palate's taste indeed love's thrice repured nectar? Death, I fear me, sounding destruction, or some joy too fine, too subtle, potent, and too sharp in sweetness for the capacity of my ruder powers. I fear it much, and I do fear besides that I shall lose distinction in my joys, as doth a battle when they charge on heaps the enemy flying.
She's making her ready. She'll come straight. You must be witty now. She does so blush, and fetches her wind so short, as she's afraid with a sprite, I'll betcha. Oh, it is the prettiest villain. She fetches her breath as short as a new chain sparrow.
Even such a passion doth embrace my bosom. My heart beats thicker than a feverous pulse, and all my powers do their bestowing lose, like vassalage at unawares, encountering the eye of majesty.
Come, come. Oh, what need you blush? Shame's a baby. Here she is now. Swear the oath now to her that you have sworn to me. Huh? Oh, what, are you born again? You must be watched ere you be made tame, must you? Come your ways, come your ways. You brought back what was put you in the field. Well, why don't you speak to her? Oh, come, let's draw this curtain and see your picture. Oh, alas the day, how loath she is to offend daylight, and what dark would close sooner. So, rub on and kiss the mistress. Oh, how now a kiss in the fee farm? Build there, carpenter, the air is sweet. Nay, you shall fight your hearts out ere I part to the falcon and the tercel for all the ducks in the river. Go to, go to.
You have bereft me of all words, lady.
Oh, words pay no debts, give a deed. But she'll bereave you of the deeds, too, if she call your activity in question. What? Billing again? Come in, I'll go get a fire.
Will you walk in, my lord?
Oh, Cressid, how oft have I wished me thus?
Wished, my lord? The gods grant. Oh, my lord.
What should they grant? What makes this pretty abruption? What
too curious drake espies my sweet lady in the fountain of our love.
More dregs than water if my fears have eyes.
Fears make devils of cherubims. They never see truly.
Blind fear that seeing reason leads find safer footing than blind reason stumbling without fear. To fear the worst oft cures the worst.
Let my lady apprehend no fear. In all Cupid's pageant there is presented no monster.
No, nothing monstrous neither.
Nothing but our undertakings.
When we swear to weep seas, live in fire, eat rocks, tame tigers, thinking it harder for our mistress to devise imposition enough than for us to undergo any difficulty imposed. This is the monstrosity in love, lady, that the will is infinite and the execution confined, that the desire is boundless and the act a slave to limit.
They say all lovers swear more performance than they are able, and yet reserve an ability that they never perform, vowing more than the perfection of 10 and discharging less than the 10th part of 1. They that have the voice of lions and the act of hares, are they not monsters?
Are there such? Such are not we. Praise us as we are tasted. Allow us as we prove. Our head shall go bare till merit crown it. No perfection and reversion shall have a praise in present. We will not name desert before his birth, and being born his addition shall be humble. Few words to fair faith. Troilus shall be such to Cressid, as what envy can say worst shall be a mock for his truth. And what truth can speak truest, not truer than Troilus?
Will you walk in, my lord?
Oh, what, are you blushing still? Have you not done talking yet?
Well, uncle, what folly I commit, I dedicate to you.
Oh, I thank you for that. If my lord get a boy of you, you'll give him me, huh? Now, you be true to my lord. If he flinch, chide me for it.
You know now your hostages. Your uncle's word and my firm faith.
Nay, I'll give my word for her too. Our kindred, though they are long ere they are wooed, they are constant being won. They are birds, I can tell you. They stick for their throne.
Boldness comes to me now and brings me heart. Prince Troilus, I have loved you night and day for many weary months.
Why was my Cressid then so hard to win?
Hard to seem won. But I was won, my lord, with the first glance. Oh, that ever pardon me. If I confess much, you will play the tyrant. I love you now, but not till now so much but I might master it. In faith I lie. My thoughts were like unbridled children grown too headstrong for their mothers. See, we fools, why have I blabbed? Who shall be true to us when we are so unsecret to ourselves? But though I loved you well, I wooed you not, and yet, good faith, I wished myself a man, or that we women had men's privilege of speaking first. Oh, sweet, bid me hold my tongue, for in this rapture I shall surely speak the thing I shall repent. See, your silence, cunning in dumbness from my weakness, draws my soul of counsel from me. Stop my mouth!
And shall, albeit sweet music issues thence.
Ooh, pretty in faith.
I do beseech you, pardon me. 'Twas not my purpose thus to beg a kiss. I am ashamed. Oh, heavens, what have I done? For this time will I take my leave, my lord.
Your leave, sweet Cressida.
Leave, and you take your leave till tomorrow morning, and I'll...
content you.
What a friend's way.
Sir, mine own company.
Come on, shun yourself.
Let me go and try.
that speaks so white.
Oh, perchance, my lord, I showed more craft than love, and fell so roundly to a large confession to angle for your thoughts. But you are wise, or else you love not, for to be wise and love exceeds man's might that dwells with God above.
Oh, that I thought it could be in a woman, as if it can, I will presume in you, to feed for aye her lamp and flames of love, to keep her constancy in plight and youth, outliving beauties outward, with a mind that doth renew swifter than blood decays. Or that persuasion could but thus convince me that my integrity and truth to you might be affronted with the match and weight of such a winnowed purity in love. How would I then uplift? But alas, I am as true as truth's simplicity, and simpler than the infancy of truth.
In that I'll war with you.
Oh, virtuous fight, when right with right wars, who shall be most right? True swains in love shall in the world to come approve their truths by Troilus. When their rhymes, full of protest, of oath, and big compare, want similes, truth tired with iteration, as true as steel, as plantage to the moon, as sun to day, as turtle to her mate, as the earth to the center, yet, after all comparisons of truth, as truth's authentic author to be cited, as true as Troilus shall crown up the verse and sanctify the numbers.
Prophet may you be, if I be false, or swerve a hair from truth, when time is old and hath forgot itself, when water drops have worn the stones of Troy, and blind oblivion swallowed cities up, and mighty states characterless are grated to dust in nothing, yet let memory from false to false, among false maids in love, upbraid my falsehood. When they've said, as false as air, as water, wind, or sandy earth, fox to the lamb, or wolf to heifer's calf, pard to the hind, or stepdame to her son, yea, let them say, to stick the heart of falsehood, as false as Cressida.
Oh, don't do a bargain, maid. Seal it, I'll be the witness, seal it. Oh, come, come. Now here I take your hand. Here are my cousins. Now, if ever you prove false to one another, since I have taken such pains to bring you together, let all pitiful goers between be called to the world's end after my name. Call them all panders. Let all constant men be Troiluses, and all false women, Cressids. And all pitiful brokers between, panders. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Henceforth, I'll show you a chamber with a bed. Which bed, because it shall not speak of your pretty encounters, press it to death. Away, away. And Cupid, grant all tongue-tied maidens here bed, chamber, and pander to provide this year.
Oh, princess. For the service I have done you, the advantage of the time prompts me aloud to call for recompense. Appear it to your mind that through the sight I bear in things to come, I have abandoned Troy, left my possessions, incurred a traitor's name, exposed myself from certain and possessed conveniences to doubtful fortunes, and here to do you service, and become as new into the world, strange, unacquainted. I do beseech you, as in way of taste, who give me now a little benefit out of those many registered in promise, which you say live to come in my behalf.
What wouldst thou of us, Troyan? Make demand.
You have a Troyan prisoner called Antenor, yesterday took, for Troy holds him very dear. Often have you, thanks, therefore, desired my Cressid in right great exchange, whom Troy hath still denied. But this Antino I know is such a rest in their affairs that their negotiations all must slack wanting his manage, and they will almost give us a prince of blood, a son of Priam in change of him. Oh, let him be sent, great princes, and he shall buy my daughter. And her presence shall quite strike off all service I have done in most accepted pain.
Let Diomedes bear him and bring us Cressid hither. Calchas shall have what he requests of us. Good Diomed, furnish you fairly for this interchange. Withal, bring word if Hector will tomorrow be answered in his challenge. Ajax is ready.
This shall I undertake, and 'tis a burden which I am proud to bear.
Achilles stands at the entrance of his tent. Please it our general to pass strangely by him as if he were forgot. And princes all lay negligent and loose regard upon him. I will come last. 'Tis like he'll question me why such unplausive eyes are bent on him. If so, I have derision medicinable to use between your strangeness and his pride, which his own will shall have desire to drink. It may do good. Pride hath no other glass to show itself but pride, for supple knees feed arrogance and are the poor man's fees.
We'll execute your purpose and put on a form of strangeness as we pass along. So do each lord, and either greet him not, or else disdainfully, which shall shake him more than if not looked on. I will lead the way.
What comes a general to speak with me? You know my mind. I'll fight no more against Troy.
What says Achilles? Would he aught with us?
Would you, my lord? Aught with the general?
No.
Nothing, my lord.
The better.
Good day. Good day. How do you? How do you?
The cuckold scorn me.
How now, Patroclus?
Tomorrow, Ajax. Huh? Good morrow.
Aye, and the good the next day, too.
What mean these fellows? Know they not Achilles?
They passed by strangely. They were used to bend, to send their smiles before them to Achilles, to come as humbly as they were used to creep to holy altars.
To certain. Greatness, once fallen out with fortune, must fall out with men, too. What the decline is, he shall as soon read in the eyes of others as feel in his own fall. For men like butterflies show not their mealy wings but to the summer. They're not a man for being simply man at any honor, but honored for those things that are without it, as place, riches, and favor, prizes of accident as oft as merit, which when they fall, as being slippery standards, the love that leaned on them has slippery too, but one plucked down another, and together died in the fall. But 'tis not so with me. Fortune and I are friends. I do enjoy at ample point all that I did possess. Save these men's looks, they do methinks find out something not worth in me such rich beholding as they have often given. There is Ulysses. I'll interrupt his reading. How now, Ulysses?
Now, great Thetis' son.
What are you reading?
Oh, a strange fellow here writes me that man, how dearly ever parted, how much in having or without or in, cannot make boast to have that which he hath, nor feels not what he owes, but by reflection, as when his virtue, shining upon others, heat them, and they retort that heat again to the first giver.
This is not strange, Ulysses. The beauty that is born here in the face, the bearer knows not, but commends itself to others' eyes. Nor doth the eye itself, that most pure spirit of sense, convey itself, not going from itself, but eye to eye opposed, salutes each other with each other's form. For beauty goes not from itself, but by speculation, and is traveled then, as it doth see itself. This is not strange at all.
I do not strain at the position. It is familiar, but at the author's drift, who in his circumstance expressly proves that no man is the lord of anything, though in him and of him there be much consisting,
till he communicate his parts to others. Nor doth he of himself know them for aught, till he behold them formed in the applause where they're extended, who, like an arch, reverberate the voice again, or like a gate of steel fronting the sun, receives and renders back his figure and his heat. I was much wrapped in this, and apprehended here immediately the unknown Ajax. Heavens, what a man is there! A very horse that has he knows not what. Nature, what things there are, most abject in regard, and dear in use. What things again, most dear in the esteem and poor in worth. Now shall we see tomorrow an act that very chance does throw upon him Ajax renowned. Oh, heavens, what some men do, while some men leave to do. How some men creep in skittish fortune's hall, while others play the idiots in her eyes. How one man eats into another's pride, while pride is feasting in his wantonness. Oh, to see these Grecian lords, why, even already they clap the lubber Ajax on the shoulder as if his foot were on brave Hector's breast and great Troy shrinking.
I do believe it. For they passed by me as misers do by beggars. Neither gave to me good word nor look. What are my deeds forgot?
Time hath, my lord, a wallet at his back, wherein he puts arms for oblivion, a great-sized monster of ingratitudes. Those scraps are good deeds past, which are devoured as soon as they are made, forgot as soon as done. Perseverance, dear my lord, keeps honor bright. To have done is to hang quite out of fashion, like a rusty mail in monumental mockery. Take the instant way, for honor travels in a strait so narrow, where one but goes abreast. Keep then the path, for emulation hath a thousand sons that one by one pursue. If you give way or hedge aside from the direct forthright, like to an entered tide, they all rush by and leave you hindmost. Or like a gallant horse fallen in first rank, lie there for pavement to the abject rear, or run and trampled on. Then what they do in present, though less than yours in past, must o'ertop yours. For time is like a fashionable host that slightly shakes his parting guest by the hand, and with his arms outstretched as he would fly, grasps in the comer. The welcome ever smiles, and farewells goes out sighing. Oh, let not virtue seek remuneration for the thing it was. For beauty, wit, high birth, vigor of bone, desert in service, love, friendship, charity are subjects all to envious and calumniating time. One touch of nature makes the whole world kin, that all with one consent praise new-born gods, though they are made and molded of things past, and give to dust, that is a little guilt, more lord than guilt, or dust it. The present eye praises the present object. Then marvel not, thou great and complete man, that all the Greeks begin to worship Ajax, since things in motion sooner catch the eye than what not stirs. The cry went once on thee, and still it might, and yet it may again. If thou wouldst not entomb thyself alive, encase thy reputation in a tent, whose glorious deeds, but in these fields of late, made emulous missions amongst the gods themselves, and drave great Mars to faction.
Of this my privacy I have strong reasons.
Against your privacy the reasons are more potent and heroical. 'Tis known, Achilles, that you are in love with one of Priam's daughters.
Known?
Is that a wonder? The providence that's in a watchful state knows almost every grain of Pluto's gold, finds bottom in the uncomprehensive deeps, keeps place with thought, and almost like the gods does thoughts unveil in their dumb cradles. There is a mystery, with whom relation durst never meddle, in the soul of state, that hath an operation more divine than breath or pen can give expression to. All the commerce that you have had with Troy as perfectly is ours as yours, my lord.
And better would it fit Achilles much to throw down Hector than Polyxena. But it must grieve young Pyrrhus now at home, when fame shall in her island sound her trump, and all the Greekish girls shall tripping sing, great Hector's sister did Achilles win, but our great Ajax bravely beat down him. Farewell, my lord. I, as your lover, speak. The fool slides o'er the ice that you should break.
To this effect, Achilles, have I moved you. A woman, impudent and mannish grown, is not more loath than an effeminate man in time of action. I stand condemned for this. They think my little stomach to the war, and your great love to me restrains you thus. Sweet, rouse yourself, and the weak, wanton Cupid shall from your neck unloose his amorous fold, and like a dewdrop from a lion's mane be shook to airy air.
So, Ajax, fight with Hector.
Aye, and perchance receive much honor by him.
I see. My reputation is at stake. I am shrewdly gored.
Oh, then beware. Those wounds heal ill that men do give themselves. Omission to do what's necessary seals a commission to a blank of danger. And danger, like an ague, subtly taints even then when we sit idly in the sun.
Go call Thersites hither, sweet Patroclus. I'll send the fool to Ajax and desire him to invite the Trojan lords after their comeback to see us here unarmed. I have a woman's longing, an appetite that I am sick withal, to see great Hector in his weeds of peace, to talk with him, and to behold his visage even to my full of view. Her labor saved.
A wonder.
What?
Ajax, goes up and down the field asking for himself.
How so?
He must fight singly tomorrow with Hector, and is so prophetically proud of an heroical cudgeling that he raves in saying nothing.
How can that be?
Why, he stalks up and down like a peacock, a stride and a stab. Ruminates like a hostess that has no arithmetic but her brain set down her reckoning. Bites his lip with a politic regard, as who would say, there were wit in his head and toward out, and so there is. But it lies coldly in him, like fire in a flint, which will not show itself without knocking, or the man's undone forever. If he break not his neck in the combat tomorrow, he'll break it himself in vainglory. He knows me not. I said, good morrow, Ajax. And he replies, thanks, Agamemnon. Now what think you of this man who takes me for the general? Oh, he's grown a very landfish, languageless, a monster. Plague of opinion, a man may wear it on either side like a leather jerkin.
Thou must be my ambassador to him, Thersites.
Well, he'll answer nobody. He professes not answering, speaking is for beggars. He wears his tongue in his arms. Here, I'll put on his presence. Let Patroclus make his demands of me. You shall see the pageant of Ajax.
To him, Patroclus. Tell him I humbly desire the valiant Ajax to invite the most valorous Hector to come unarmed to my tent, and to procure safe conduct for his person of the magnanimous and most illustrious 6 or 7 times honored captain general of the Grecian army, Agamemnon, etc. Do this.
Jove bless great Ajax. I come from worthy Achilles. Who most humbly desires you to invite great Hector to his tent. And to procure safe conduct from Agamemnon.
Agamemnon?
Why, my lord? What say you to it?
Oh, God by you with all my heart.
Your answer, sir.
Tomorrow be a fair day. By 11 o'clock it will go one way or the other. Howsoever, he shall pay for me ere he has me.
Your answer, sir.
Very well, with all my heart.
Nay, why, but he is not in this tune, is he?
Oh, nobody is out of tune thus. And what music will be in him when Hector has knocked out his brains, I know not, but I am sure none. Unless the fiddler Apollo get his sinews to make catlings on.
Come. Thou shalt bear a letter to him straight.
Now let me bear another to his horse. I think that's the more capable creature.
My mind is troubled like a fountain stirred. And I myself sing at the bottom of it.
Oh, would the fountain of your mind were clear again.
That I might water an ass at it. I had rather be a tick in a sheep than such a valiant ignorance.
Hey, oh, who is that there? Oh, it's the Lord Aeneas.
Is the prince there in person? Had I so good occasion to lie long as you, Prince Paris, nothing but heavenly business should rob my bedmate of my company.
That's my mind, too. Good morrow, Lord Aeneas.
A noble Greek Aeneas. Take his hair. Witness the process of your speech wherein you told how Diomede, in a whole week by days, did haunt you in the field.
Health to you, valiant sir, during all the question of this gentle truce. But when I meet you armed, as black defiance as heart can think or courage execute.
But the one and other Diomede embraces. Our bloods are now in call, and so long health. But when contention and occasion meet, by Jove, I'll play the hunter for thy life, with all my force, pursuit, and policy.
And thou shalt hunt a lion will fly with his face backward in humane gentleness. Welcome to Troy.
Ah, by Anchises' life, welcome indeed.
By Venus' hand, I swear no man alive can love in such a sort the thing he means to kill more excellently.
We sympathize. Jove, let Aeneas live. If to my sword his fate be not the glory, 1,000 complete courses of the sun, but in mine emulous honor let him die, with every joint a wound, and that tomorrow.
We know each other well.
We do, and long to know each other worse.
This is the most despitefulest gentle greeting, the noblest hateful love that e'er I heard of. What business, Lord, so early?
I was sent for to the king, but why, I know not.
His purpose meet you. Was to bring this Greek to Calchas' house, and there to render him for the infreed Antina the fair Cressid. Let's have your company, or if you please.
Haste there before us. I constantly do think, or rather call my thoughts a certain knowledge. My brother Troilus lodges there tonight. Rouse him and give him note of our approach, for the whole quality whereof I fear we shall be much unwelcome.
That I assure you. Troilus had rather Troy were born to Greece than Cressid born from Troy.
There's no help. Bitter disposition of the time, we'll have it so. On, Lord, we'll follow you.
Whoa!
And tell me, noble Diomede. Faith, tell me true. Even in the soul of sound good fellowship, who in your thoughts merits fair Helen most? Myself or Menelaus?
Both alike. He merits well to have her that doth seek her, not making any scruple of her soilure with such a hell of pain and world of charge. And you as well to keep her, that defend her, not palating the taste of her dishonor with such a costly loss of wealth and friends. He, like a puling cuckold, would drink up the lees and dregs of a flat-tamed piece. You, like a lecher out of whorish loins, are pleased to breed out your inheritors. Both merits poised, each ways no less nor more, but he as he, the heavier for a whore.
You're too bitter to your country,
woman. She's bitter to her country. Hear me, Paris. For every false drop in her body veins, a Grecian's life hath sunk. For every scruple of her contaminated carrion weight, a Trojan hath been slain. Since she could speak, she hath not given so many good words breath. As for her, Greeks and Trojans suffer death.
Fair Diomede, you do as chapmen do. Dispraise the thing that you desire to buy. But we in silence hold this virtue well. We'll not commend what we intend to sell. Here lies our way.
Dear, trouble not yourself. The morn is cold.
Then, sweet my lord, I'll call mine uncle down. He shall unbolt the gates.
Oh, trouble him not. To bed, to bed. Sleep, kill those pretty eyes, and give a soft attachment to thy senses as infants, empty of all thought.
Tomorrow, then.
I pretty now. To bed.
Are you aweary of me?
Oh, Cressid. But that the busy day waked by the lark hath roused the ribald crows, and dreaming night will hide our joys no longer. I would not from thee.
Night hath been too brief.
Beshrew the witch. With venomous white she stays as hideously as hell.
flies the grasps of love with wings more momentary, swift than thought. You will catch cold and curse me.
I prithee tarry. You men will never tarry, foolish Cressid. I might have still held off, and then you would have parried.
How now, how now?
Hark, there's one up.
Watch all the doors open here.
It is your uncle.
Oh, a pestilence on him. Now will he be mocking. Oh, I shall have such a life.
How now, how now? Well, how go maidenhead, here, you maid. Where is my cousin Cressida?
Go hang yourself, you naughty mocking uncle. You bring me to do, and then you flout me too.
To do what? To do what? Let us say what. What have I brought you to do?
Come, come, beshrew your heart. You'll ne'er be good nor suffer others.
Alas, poor wench, a poor chipotle has not slept tonight. Would he not, naughty man, let it sleep? A bugbear take him.
Did not I tell you? Would he were knocked in the head. Who is that at door? Good uncle, go and see. My lord, come you again into my chamber. Oh, you smile and mock me as if I meant naught of it. Come, you are deceived. I think of no such thing. How earnestly they knock. Pray you come in. I would not for half Troy have you seen here.
How now? What's the matter? Will you beat down the door? Who's there? What's the matter?
Tomorrow.
How now? Who is it? Oh, my lord and ears. By my troth, I knew you not. What's news with you so early, huh?
Is not Prince Troilus here?
Here? What should he do here?
Come, he is here, my lord. Do not deny him. It doth import him much to speak with me.
Is he here, say? Well, it is more than I know, I'll be sworn. For my part, I came in rather late. What should he do here?
Too late, then! Come, come, you'll do him wrong ere you're aware! Will he so prove him to be false to him? Do not you know of him, but yet go fetch him hither, go!
How now? What's the matter?
My lord, my matter is so rash, I scarce have leisure to salute you. There is at hand Paris, your brother, and Deiphobus, the Grecian Diomede, and our Antina delivered to us, and for him, forthwith, ere the first sacrifice, within this hour, we must give up to Diomede's hand the Lady Cressida.
Is it concluded so?
By Priam and the general state of Troy, they are at hand and ready to effect it.
Oh, my achievements mock me. I will go meet them. And my lord Aeneas, we met by chance. You did not find me here.
Good. Good, my lord. The secrets of nature have not more gift in taciturnity.
Is it possible? No sooner got but lost. Oh, the devil take Antino. The young prince will go mad. A plague upon Antino. Would they have broke his neck?
Come on. What's the matter? Who was here?
Oh.
Why sigh you so profoundly? Where's my lord? Gone?
Yes.
Oh, tell me, sweet uncle, what's the matter?
Oh, would I were as deep under the earth as I am upon it.
Oh, the gods, what's the matter?
Pretty get thee in. Wouldst thou had ne'er been born, I knew thou'd be his death. Oh, poor gentleman, a plague upon Antino.
Good uncle, I beseech you, on my knees, I beseech you, what's the matter?
Thou must be gone, wench. Thou must be gone. Thou art changed for Antenor. Thou must to thy father and be gone from Troilus. Will be his death, will be his bane. He cannot bear it.
Oh, you immortal gods. I will not go.
Thou must.
I will not, uncle. I have forgot my father. I know no touch of consanguinity. No kin, no love, no blood, no soul so near me as the sweet Troilus. Oh, you gods divine, make Cressid's name the very crown of falsehood if ever she leave Troilus. Time, force, and death do to this body what extremity you can. The strong base and building of my love is as the very center of the earth, drawing all things to it. I need to go in and weep.
Do, do.
valiant Greek comes fast apart. But my brother Troilus, tell you the lady what she is to do and haste her to the purpose.
Walk into her house. I'll bring her to the Grecian presently. And to his hand when I deliver her, think it an altar and my brother Troilus a priest. There offering to it his own heart.
Please you walk in, my lords. I know what 'tis to love. Moon as I should pity, I could help.
Oh, be moderate, be moderate.
Why tell you me of moderation? The grief is fine, full, perfect that I taste. And no less than a sense as strong as that which causeth it. How can I moderate it? If I could temporize with my affection, or brew it to a weak and colder palate, the like allayment could I give my grief. My love admits no qualifying dross, no more my grief in such a precious loss.
Oh, here he comes, a sweet duck.
Oh, Troilus!
Oh! What a pair of spectacles is here. Let me embrace, too. Oh, heart. As the goodly saying is, oh, heart, heavy heart, why sighest thou without breaking? Where he answers again, because thou canst not ease thy smart by friendship nor by speaking. There was never a truer rhyme. Let us cast away nothing, for we may live to have need of such a verse. We see it. We see it. Oh, how now, lambs?
Cressid, I love thee in so strange a purity that the blessed gods are angry with my fancy. More bright in zeal than the devotion which cold lips blow to their deities. Take thee from me.
Have the gods envy?
Aye, 'tis too plain a case.
And is it true?
A hateful truth.
I must go from Troy, and from Troilus too.
From Troy, and Troilus.
Is it possible?
And suddenly, where injury of chance puts back leave-taking, jostles roughly by all time of pause, rudely beguiles our lips of all rejoinder, forcibly prevents our locked embraces, and strangles our dear vows even in the birth of our own laboring breath. We two that with so many thousand sighs did by each other, must poorly sell ourselves with a rude brevity and discharge of one. Injurious time now with a robber's haste crams his rich thievery up he knows not how. As many farewells as be stars in heaven, with distinct breath and consigned kisses to them, he fumbles up into a lucid view and scants us with a single famished kiss, distasting with the salt of broken tears.
My lord, is the lady ready?
You are called. Some say the genius so cries, come to him that instantly must die.
Bid them have patience, she shall come anon.
Oh, where are my tears? Rain you lay this wind, and my heart will be blown up by the roots.
I must then to the Grecians.
No remedy.
A woeful Cressid amongst the merry Greeks. When shall we see again?
Hear me, my love. Be thou but true of heart.
Aye, true. How now? What wicked deed is this?
Nay, we must use expostulation kindly, for it is parting from us. I speak not, be thou true as fearing thee, for I will throw my glove to death himself, that there's no maculation in thy heart. Be thou true, say I, to fashion in my sequent protestation. Be thou true, and I will see thee.
You shall be exposed, my lord, to dangers as infinite as imminent. But I'll be true.
And I'll grow friend with danger. Wear this sleeve.
And you, this glove. When shall I see you?
I will corrupt the Grecian sentinels to give thee nightly visitation. But yet, be true.
Oh, heavens! Be true again!
Hear why I speak it, love. The Grecian youths are full of quality. They're loving well composed, with gifts of nature flowing and swelling o'er with arts and exercise. How novelties may move and part with person. Alas, a kind of godly jealousy, which I beseech you call a virtuous sin, makes me afraid.
Oh, heavens! You love me not!
Die, I am villain, then. In this, I do not call your faith in question so mainly as my merit. I cannot sing, nor heal the high revolt, nor sweeten talk, nor play at subtle games. Fair virtues all, to which the Grecians are most prompt and pregnant. But I can tell that in each grace of these, there lurks a still and dumb discourse of devil that tempts most cunningly. But be not tempted.
Do you think I will?
No, but something may be done that we will not. Sometimes we are devils to ourselves, and we attempt the frailty of our powers, presuming on their changeful potence.
Nay, good my lord!
Come, kiss him as a spark.
Brother Troilus?
Good brother, come you hither and bring Aeneas and the Grecian with you.
My lord, will you be true?
Who, I? Alas, it is my vice, my fault. Whilst others fish with craft for great opinion, I with great truth catch mere simplicity. Whilst some with cunning gild their copper crowns, with truth and plainness I do wear mine bare. Fear not my truth. The moral of my wit is plain and true. There's all the reach of it.
Welcome, Sir Diomed. Here is the lady which for Antina we deliver you.
At the port, lord, I'll give her to thy hand, and by the way, possess thee what she is. Entreat her fair, and by my soul, fair Greek, if e'er thou standst at mercy of my sword, name Cressid, and thy life shall be as safe as Priam is in Ilium.
Fair lady Cressid, so please you save the thanks this prince expects. The luster in your eye, heaven in your cheek, plead your fair usage, and to Diomed you shall be mistress, and command him wholly.
Grecian, thou dost not use me courteously to shame the zeal of my petition towards in praising her. I tell thee, lord of Greece, she is as far high soaring all thy praises as thou unworthy to be called her servant. I charge thee use her well, even for my charge, or by the dreadful Pluto, if thou dost not, for the great bulk Achilles be thy god, I'll cut thy throat.
Oh, be not moved, Prince Troilus. Let me be privileged by my place and message to be a speaker free. When I am hence, I'll answer to my lust, and know, my lord, I'll nothing do on charge. To her own worth she shall be prized, but that you say, be it so. I'll speak it in my spirit and honor, know.
Come to the port! I'll tell thee, Diomed. This brave shall oft make thee to hide thy head. Give me your hand, lady. And as we walk, to our own selves bend we our needful talk.
Our Hector's trumpet!
How have we spent the morning?
A prince must think me tardy and remiss that swore to ride before him to the field today.
Tis Troilus' fault.
Come, the field.
Let us make ready straight.
Yea, with the bridegroom's fresh alacrity, let us address to tend on Hector's heels.
The glory of our Troy doth this day lie on his fair worth and single chivalry.
Here art thou in appointment fresh and fair, anticipating time. With starting courage, give with thy trumpet a loud note to Troy, thou dreadful Ajax, that the appalled air may pierce the head of the great combatant and hail him hither.
Now, trumpet, here's my purse. Now crack thy lungs and split thy brazen pipe. Blow, villain! To the sphered buyer's cheek art swell the colic of puffed aquiline. Come, stretch thy chest, and let thy eyes spark blood. Thou blowest for Hector!
No trumpet answers.
It is but early days.
Is not yon Diomed with Calchas' daughter?
Tis he. I ken the manner of his gait. He rises on the toe. That spirit of his in aspiration lifts him from the earth.
Is this the Lady Cressy?
Even she.
Most dearly welcome to the Greeks, sweet lady.
Our general does salute you with a kiss.
Yet is the kindness but particular. Were better she were kissed in general.
Ooh, and very courtly counsel. I'll begin. So much for Nestor.
I'll take that winter from your lips, fair lady. Achilles bid you welcome.
I had good argument for kissing once.
Oh, but that's no argument for kissing now. For thus popped Paris in his hardiment, and parted thus you and your argument.
Oh, deadly gall and theme of all our scorns, for which we lose our heads to gild his horns.
The first was Menelaus' kiss. This mine, Patroclus kisses you.
Oh, this is trim.
Thus Paris and I kiss evermore for him.
I'll have my kiss, sir. Lady, by your leave.
In kissing, do you render or receive?
Both, give and take.
I'll make my match to live. The kiss you take is better than you give, therefore no kiss.
I'll give you boot. I'll give you 3 for 1.
You're an odd man. Give even or give none.
An odd man, lady. Every man is odd.
No, Paris is not. For you know, 'tis true that you are odd. And he is even with you.
Go, fellow, me other hand.
No, I'll be sworn.
It were no match your nail against his horn. May I, sweet lady, beg a kiss of you?
You may.
I do desire it.
Why, beg then, do.
Why then, for Venus' sake, give me a kiss when Helen is a maid again and his.
I am your debtor. Claim it when 'tis due.
Never is my day, and then a kiss of you.
Lady, a word. I'll bring you to your father.
A woman of quick sense.
Oh, fie, fie upon her. There's language in her eye, her cheek, her lip, nay, her foot speaks. Her wanton spirits look out at every joint and motive of her body. Oh, these encounterers, so glib of tongue, that give a costing welcome ere it comes, and wide unclasp the tables of their hearts to every ticklish reader, set them down for sluttish spoils of opportunity and daughters of the game.
Troyan trumpet.
Yonder comes the troop.
Hail, all you state of Greece. What shall be done to him that victory commands? Or do you purpose a victor shall be known? Will you the knight shall to the edge of all extremity pursue each other, or shall be divided by any voice or order of the field? Hector bade ask.
Which way would Hector have it?
He cares not, he'll obey conditions.
It is done proudly, and proudly done. Very proudly, and great deal disprising the knight opposed.
If not Achilles, sir, what is your name?
If not Achilles, nothing.
Therefore Achilles. But whate'er, know this.
In the extremity of great and little, valor and pride excel themselves in Hector. The one almost as infinite as all, the other blank as nothing. Weigh him well. And that which looks like pride is courtesy. This Ajax is half made of Hector's blood, in love whereof half Hector stays at home. Half heart, half hand, half Hector comes to seek this splendid knight. Half Trojan and half Greek.
A maiden battle then, I perceive you.
Here is Sir Diomed. Go, gentle knight, stand by our Ajax. As you and Lord Aeneas consent upon the order of their fight, so be it. Either to a breath, or else the uttermost. The combatants being kin, have stints their strife before their strokes begin.
Well, they are opposed already.
What Troian is that same that looks so heavy?
The youngest son of Priam. A true knight. They call him Troilus. Not yet mature, yet matchless, firm in words, speaking in deeds. Yet deedless in his tongue, not soon provoked, nor being provoked, soon calmed. His heart and hand both open and both free, for what he has he gives, what thinks he shows. Yet gives he not till judgment guide his bounty, nor dignifies an impaired thought with bread. Manly as Hector, but more dangerous. For Hector, in his blaze of wrath, subscribes to tender objects. But he, in heat of action, is more vindicative than jealous love. They call him Troilus, and on him erect a second hope as fairly built as Hector. Thus says Aeneas, one that knows the youth even to his inches, and with private soul did in great Ilion thus translate him to me.
They are in action! Hector now sleeps, the white man! Ajax, his blows are well disposed there, Ajax!
No more!
Prince is enough, so please you.
I'm not warm yet. Let us fight again.
As Hector pleases.
Why then will I no more? Thou art great lord, my father's sister's son, a cousin German to great Priam's seed. The obligation of our blood forbids a gory emulation twixt us twain. Were thy commixture Greek and Trojan so, that thou could say this hand is Grecian all, and this is Trojan, the sinews of this leg all Greek, and this all Troy. My mother's blood runs in the dexter cheek, this sinister bounds in my father's. By Jove multipotent, thou shouldst not bear from me a Greekish member, wherein my sword had not impression made of our rank feud. But the just gods gainsay that any drop thou borrowest from thy mother, my sacred aunt, should by my mortal sword be drained. Let me embrace thee, Ajax. By him that thunders, thou hast lusty arms. Hector would have them fall upon him thus. Cousin, all honor to thee.
I thank thee, Hector. Thou art too gentle and too free a man. I came to kill thee, cousin, and bear hence a great addition, and in thy death.
Not Neoptolemus so mirable, on whose bright crest fame with a loud stoies cries, this is he, could promise to himself a thought of added honor torn from Hector.
There is expectance here from both the sides what further you will do.
We'll answer it. The issue is embracement. Ajax, farewell.
I might in entreaties find success, as seldom I have the chance. I would desire my famous cousin to our Grecian tent.
It is Agamemnon's wish, and great Achilles doth long to see unarmed the valiant Hector.
Aeneas, call my brother Troilus to me, and signify this loving interview to the expecter of our Trojan part. Cousin, give me thy hand. I will go eat with thee and see your knights.
Great Agamemnon comes to meet us here.
The worthiest of them, tell me name by name, but for Achilles, mine own searching eyes will find him by his large and portly size.
Worthy of arms, as welcome to one that would be rid of such an enemy. But that's no welcome. Understand more clear. What's past and what's to come is strewed with husks and formless ruins of oblivion. But in this extant moment, faith and troth, strained purely from all hollow bias drawing, bids thee with most divine integrity, from heart of very heart, great Hector, welcome.
I thank thee, most imperious Agamemnon.
My well-famed lord of Troy, no less to you.
Let me confirm my princely brother's greeting. You brace of warlike brothers, welcome hither.
Who must we answer?
The noble Menelaus.
Oh,
you, my lord. By Mars, his gauntlet thanks, mock not that I affect the untraded oath. Your quondam wife swears still by Venus' glove. She's well, but bade me not commend her to you.
Name her not now, sir. She's a deadly theme.
Oh, pardon. I offend.
I have, thou gallant Trojan, seen thee oft laboring for destiny, make cruel way through ranks of Greekish youth, and I have seen thee, heartless Perseus, spur thy Phrygian steed, and seen thee scoring forfeits and subduements, when thou hast hung thy advanced sword in the air, not letting it decline on the decline. That have I set to my standards by. No. Jupiter is yonder dealing life, and I have seen thee pause and take thy breath when that a ring of Greeks have hemmed thee in, like an Olympian wrestling. This I have seen, But this thy countenance, still locked in steel, I never saw till now. I knew thy grandsire, and once fought with him. Oh, he was a soldier good, but my great Mars, the captain of us all, never liked thee. Oh, let an old man embrace thee, and worthy warrior, welcome to our tent.
The old master.
Oh, welcome to thee, a good old chronicle, that has so long walked hand in hand with time. Most reverend Nestor, I am glad to clasp thee.
Oh, I would my arms could match thee in contention as they contend with thee in courtesy.
I would they could.
Oh, by this white beard, I'd fight with thee tomorrow. Well, welcome, welcome. I have seen the time.
I wonder now how yonder city stands, since we have here her base and pillar by us.
I know your favor, Lord Ulysses, well. Ah, sir, there's many a Greek and Trojan dead since first I saw yourself and Diomed in Ilion on your Greekish embassy.
Sir, I foretold you then what would ensue. My prophecy is but half his journey yet. For yonder walls that pertly front your town, yon towers whose wanton tops do bust the clouds, must kiss their own feet.
I must not believe you. There they stand yet. Hmm. And modestly, I think, the fall of every Phrygian stone will cost a drop of Grecian blood. The end crowns all, and that old common arbitrator time will one day end it.
So to him we leave it. Most gentle and most valiant Hector, welcome. After the general, I beseech you next to feast with me and meet me at my tent.
I shall forestall thee, Lord Ulysses. Now, Hector, I have fed mine eyes on thee. I have an exact view perused thee, Hector, and quoted joint by joint.
Is this Achilles?
I am Achilles.
Stand fair, I presume. Let me look on you.
Behold thy fill.
Nay, I have done already.
Nor too brief. I will the second time, as I would by thee, view thee limb by limb.
Oh, like a book of sport, thou'lt read me o'er. But there's more in me than thou understand. Why dost thou so oppress me with thine eye?
Tell me, you heavens, in which part of his body shall I destroy him? Whether it be there or there or there, that I may give the local wound a name and make distinct the very breach whereout Hector's great spirit flew. Answer me, heavens!
It would discredit the blessed god, proud man, to answer such a question. Stand again. Thinkst thou to catch my life so pleasantly as to predominate in nice conjecture where thou'll hit me dead?
I tell thee yea!
Wert thou the oracle to tell me so, I'd not believe thee. Henceforth, guard thee well, for I'll not kill thee there, nor there, nor there, but by the forge that stithied Mars' his helm, I'll kill thee everywhere, yea, o'er and o'er. You wisest Grecians, pardon me this brag. His insolence draws folly from my lips, that I'll endeavor deeds. Or may I never...
Do not chase thee, cousin. And you, Achilles, let these threads alone till accident of purpose bring you to it. You may have every day enough of Hector if you have stomach. The general state, I fear, can scarce entreat you to be odd with him.
I pray you let us see you in the field. We have had pelting wars since you refused the Grecian cause.
Dost thou entreat me, Hector? Tomorrow shall I meet thee fell as death. Tonight, all friends.
I am on that match.
First, all you peers of Greece, go to my tent. There in the full convive you. Afterwards, as Hector's leisure and your bounty shall concur together, severally entreated. Beat loud the tambourines! Let the trumpets blow! That this great soldier may his welcome know.
My Lord Ulysses, tell me, I beseech you, in what place of the field doth Calchas keep?
At Menelaus' tent, most princely Troilus. There, Diomed doth feast with him tonight, who neither looks on heaven nor on earth, but gives all gaze and bent of amorous view on the fair Cressida.
Shall I, sweet sir, be bound to thee so much after we part from Agamemnon's tent to bring me thither?
Well, you shall command me, sir. As gentle, tell me, of what honor was this Cressida in Troy? Had she no lover there that wails her absence?
No, sir. To such as boasting show their scars, a mock is due.
Will you walk on, my lord? She was beloved. She loved.
She is and doth.
But still, sweet love is food for fortune's tooth.
I'll heat his blood with Greekish wine tonight, which with my scimitar I'll cool tomorrow. Patroclus, let us feast him to the heights.
Here comes the sight.
How now, the core of envy, the crusty batch of nature, what's the news?
Picture of what thou seemst, and idol of idiot worshippers.
Here's a letter for thee.
From whence, fragment?
Oh, thou full dish of fool from Troy.
Who keeps the tent now?
The surgeon's box or the patient's wound?
Oh, well said, adversity. And what need these tricks?
I prithee, boy, be silent. I profit not by thy talk. Thou art thought to be Achilles' male varlet.
Male varlet, you rogue, what's that?
Why, his masculine whore. Now the rotten diseases of the south, guts griping ruptures, catarrhs, loads of gravel in the back, lethargies, cold palsies, raw eyes, dirt rotten livers, whissing lungs, bladders full of impostume, sciaticas, lime kills in the palm, the incurable bone ache, and the riddled fee simple of the tetter. Take and take again such preposterous discoveries.
Thou damnable box of envy, thou! What means thou to curse thus?
Do I curse thee?
No! Thou ruinest but the whoreson cur!
No? Why then art thou exasperate, thou idle immaterial skein of sleeve silk, thou green sauce knit flap for a sore eye, thou tassel of a prodigal's purse, thou, oh, how the poor world is pestered with such water flies, diminutives of nature,
out, gall,
finch egg.
My sweet Patroclus, I'm thwarted quite for my great purpose in tomorrow's battle. Here is a letter from Queen Hecuba, a token from her daughter, my fair love, both taxing me and gauging me to keep an oath that I have sworn. I will not break it. Fall Greece, fail fame, honor or go or stay, my major vow lies here. This I'll obey. Come, come, Thersites, help to trim my tent. This night in banqueting must all be spent. Away, Patroclus.
With too much blood and too little brains, these two may run mad. But if with too much brain and too little blood they do, why then I'll be a curer of madmen. Now there's Agamemnon, an honest fellow enough, one that loves quails, but hath not so much brain as earwax. And the goodly transformation of Jupiter, his brother there. The bull, the primitive statue and oblique memorial of cuckolds. To what form but that he is? Should wit, larded with malice, and malice forced with wit, turn him to? To an ass? Well, nothing, for he's both ass and ox. To an ox? Well, nothing, for he's both ox and ass. To be a dog, a mule, a cat, a fichu, a lizard, a toad, an owl, a herring, or a herring without a roe, I would not care. But to be Menelaus, I would conspire against destiny. Oh, ask me not what I would be if I were not Thersites, for I would not care to be the louse of a lazar, so I were not Menelaus. Hoide, spirits and fires!
We go wrong!
No, it's yonder there where we see the light.
No, not a whit.
Welcome, brave Hector. Welcome, princes all.
So now, fair prince of Troy, I bid good night. Ajax commands the guard to tend on you.
Thanks, and good night to the Greeks' general.
Good night, my lord.
Good night, sweet lord Menelaus.
Sweet draught, sweet clothes, sweet sink, sweet sewer.
Good night and welcome. Both at once that go, that those who go or tarry.
Good night.
Old Nestor, Therese, and you too, Diomed, keep Hector company an hour or two.
I cannot, Lord. I have important business. The tide whereof is now.
Oh, farewell.
Good night, great Hector.
Give me thy hand.
Follow his torch. He goes to Calchas' tent. I'll keep you company.
Sweet sir, you honor me.
And so, good night.
Come into my tent.
Same Diomed, rogue, a most unjust name. I will no more trust him when he lives than a serpent when it hisses.
Oh, he will spend his mouth and promise like Brabble the Hound. But when he performs, astronomers foretell it that it is prodigious there will come some change. The sun borrows of the moon when Diomed keeps his word. I will rather leave to see Hector than not to dog him. They say he keeps a Trojan drab and uses the traitor Calchas his tent. I'll after. Nothing but lechery, all incontinent varmints.
What are you up here? Ho! Speak!
Who called?
Diomed! Calchas, I think. Where's your daughter?
He comes to you.
Stand where the torch may not discover us.
Cressid comes forth to him.
How now, my child?
Now, my sweet guardian, half a word with you.
Yea, so familiar.
She will sing any man at first sight.
And any man may sing her if he can take her clip. She's noted.
Will you remember?
Remember, yes.
Nay, but do then, and let your mind be coupled with your word.
What should she remember?
List.
Sweet honey Greek. Tempt me no more to folly.
Roguery.
Nay, then.
I'll tell you what.
Foe, come tell a pin you are a forsworn.
In faith, I cannot. What would you have me do?
A juggling trick, to be secretly open.
What did you swear you'd bestow on me?
I prithee do not hold me to mine oath. Bid me do anything but that, sweet grief.
Hold patience.
How now, Trojan?
Diomed.
No, good night. I'll be your fool no more.
Thy better must.
Hark one word in your ear.
Oh, plague and madness.
You are moved, Prince. Let us depart, I pray you, lest your displeasure should enlarge itself to wrathful terms. This place is dangerous, the time right deadly. Let us go.
Behold, I pray you.
You have not patience. Come.
I pray thee stay.
No.
I pray thee stay. By hell and hell's torments, I will not speak a word.
Night.
Nay, but you part in anger.
Doth that grieve thee? Oh, withered truth.
How now, my lord?
Nay, by Jove, I will be patient.
Guardian, why grieve?
Pull forward you palter.
Oh, in faith, I do not. Come hither once again.
You shake, my lord, at something. Will you go? You will break out.
She strokes his cheek.
Come.
Nay, stay, by Jove, I will not speak a word.
There is between my will and all offences a guard of patience. Stay a little while.
Oh, the devil luxury with this fat rump and potato fingers tickles these two together. Fry, lechery, fry.
But will you then?
In faith, I will, though. Never trust me else.
Give me some token for the surety of it.
I'll fetch you one.
My lord. You have sworn patience.
Fear me not, sweet lord. I will not be myself, nor have cognition of what I feel. I am all patience.
Now the pledge. Now.
Here, Diomed. Keep this sleeve.
Oh, beauty, where is thy faith?
My lord.
By Jove, I will be patient. Oh, outwardly, I will.
That sleeve. Behold it well. He loved me. Give it me again.
Whose was it?
It is no matter now. I have it again. I will not meet with you tomorrow night. I prithee, Diomed, visit me no more.
Oh, now she sharpens. Well said, Whetstone.
I shall have it.
For this?
Aye, that.
Gods. Oh, pretty, pretty pledge. Thy master now lies thinking in his bed of thee and me. Sighs and takes my glove and gives memorial dainty kisses to it as I kiss thee.
Nay, do not snatch it from me.
He that takes that takes my heart withal.
I had your heart before. This follows it.
Oh,
I did swear patience.
You shall not have it, Diomed. Fate, you shall not. I'll give you something else.
No, I shall have this. Whose was it?
It is no matter.
Come, tell me whose it was.
It was one that loved me better than you will. But now you have it, take it.
Whose was it?
By all Diana's waiting women yon. And by herself. I will not tell you who.
Tomorrow will I wear it on my helm and grieve his spirit that dares not challenge it.
Wert thou the devil and waterst it on thy horn, it should be challenged.
Well, tis done, tis past. And yet it is not. I will not keep my word.
Why then, farewell. Thou shalt never mock Diomed again.
You shall not go. One cannot speak a word, but it straight starts.
I do not like this fool.
Oh, nor I, by Pluto, but that likes not me pleases me best.
What shall I come? The hour.
I come. Do come, I shall be plagued.
Farewell till then.
Good night. I prithee come. On thee, but with my heart the other eye doth see. Poor our sex. This fault in us I find, the error of our eye directs our mind. What error leads must err. Then conclude, minds swayed by eyes are full of
a proof of strength, she could not publish more unless she say, my mind is now turned whore.
All's done, my lord.
It is.
Why stay we then?
To make a recordation to my soul of every syllable that here was spoke. But if I tell how these two did coact, shall I not lie in publishing of truth? Sith yet there is a credence in my heart, an aspirant so obstinately strong that doth invert the attest of eyes and ears, as if those organs had deceptious functions created only to calumny. Was Cressid here?
Well, I cannot conjure, Troian.
She was not sure.
Most sure she was.
Why, my negation hath no taste of madness.
Nor mine, my lord. Cressida was here, but now...
Let it not be believed for womanhood. Think, we had mothers. Do not give advantage to stubborn critics, apt without a theme for deprivation, to square the general sex by Cressid's rule. Rather think this not, Cressid.
What hath she done, prince, that can soil our mothers?
Nothing at all. Unless that this were she.
Will he swagger himself out on his own eyes?
Is she? No, this is Diomed's Cressida. If beauty have a soul, this is not she. If souls died vows, if vows are sanctimony, if sanctimony be the gods' delight, if there be rule in unity itself, this is not she. Oh, madness of discourse. That cause sets up with and against itself bifold authority, where reason can revolt without perdition, and loss assume all reason without revolt. This is and is not Cressid. Within my soul there doth conduce a fight of this strange nature, that a thing inseparate divides more wider than the sky and earth. And yet the spacious breadth of this division admits no orifice for a point as subtle as Ariadne's broken woof to enter. Instance or instance, strong as Pluto's gates, Cressid is mine, tied with the bonds of heaven. Instance or instance, strong as heaven itself, the bonds of heaven are slipped, dissolved and loosed, and with another knot, five finger tied, fractions of her faith, thoughts of her love,
the fragments and scraps, the bits and greasy relics of her orient and faith are bound to Diomed.
May worthy Troilus be but half attached with that which here is passioned of its breast.
Aye, Greek, and that shall be divulged well in characters as red as Mars, his heart inflamed with Venus. Never did young man fancy with so eternal and so fixed a soul. Ah, Greek, as much as I do Cressid love, so much by weight hate I her Diomed. That sleeve is mine that he'll bear in his helm. Were it a cask composed of Vulcan's skill, my sword should bite it. Not the dreadful spout which shipmen to the Hurricane call, constringed in mass by the almighty sun, shall dizzy with more clamor Neptune's ear in his descent, and shall my prompted sword falling on Diomed.
He'll tickle it for his concubine.
Oh, Cressid. Oh, false, Cressid. False, false, false! Let all untruths stand by thy stated name and they'll seem glorious.
Oh, contain yourself. Your passion draws years hither.
I've been seeking you this hour, my lord.
Hector by this is arming him in Troy. Ajax, your guard, stays to conduct you home.
Have with you, prince. My courteous lord, at you.
Farewell, revolted fair. And Diomed, stand fast and wear a castle on thy head.
I'll bring you to the gates.
Accept distracted thanks.
Would I could meet that rogue, Diomed. I would croak like a raven. I would bode, I would bode. Patroclus will give me anything for the intelligence of this whore. A parrot will do no more for an almond than he for a commodious drab. Lechery, lechery, still wars and lechery. Nothing else holds fashion. A burning devil take him.
My lord saw the Trojan tempered to stop his ears against admonishment. On arm, do not fight today.
You train me to offend you. Get you gone. By all the everlasting gods, I'll go.
My dreams will sure prove ominous to the day.
No more, I say.
Where is my brother Hector? Here, sister. Armed and bloody and intent. Consort with me in loud and dear petition. Pursue him on knees. I have dreamt on bloody turbulence. For this whole night hath nothing been but shapes and forms of slaughter.
Oh, 'tis true.
Oh, bid my trumpet sound.
No notes of sally for the heavens, sweet brother.
Be gone, I say. The gods have heard me swear.
The gods are deaf to hot and peevish vows. They are polluted offerings, more abhorred than spotted livers in the sacrifice.
Oh, be persuaded. Do not count it holy to hurt by being just. It is as lawful, for we would give much to use violent thefts and rob in the behalf of charity.
It is the purpose that makes strong the vow, but vows to every purpose must not hold. On arm, sweet Hector.
Hold you still, I say. My honor keeps the weather of my fate. Life every man holds dear, but the dear man holds honor far more precious dear than life. Ah, now, young man. Meanst thou to fight today?
Cassandra, call my father to persuade.
No, faith, young Troilus, doff thy harness, youth. I am today in the vein of chivalry. Let grow thy sinews till their nuts be strong, and tempt not yet the brushes of the war. Unarm thee, go, and doubt thou not, brave boy. I'll stand today for thee and me and Troy.
Brother, you have a vice of mercy in you which better fits a lion than a man.
What vice is that? Good Troilus, chide me for it.
When many times the captive Grecian falls, even in the fan and wind of your fair sword, you bid them rise and live.
Well, 'tis fair play.
Fool's play, by heaven, Hector!
How now, how now?
For the love of all the gods, let's leave the hermit pity with our mothers. And when we have our armors buckled on, the venomed vengeance ride upon our swords. Spur them to ruthful work, rein them from ruth.
Fie, savage, fie.
Hector, then 'tis wars.
Troilus, I would not have you fight today.
Who should withhold me?
Not fate, obedience, nor the hand of Mars beckoning with fiery truncheon my attire. Not
Priamus or Hecuba knees, their eyes all galled with recourse of tears. Not you, my brother, with your true sword drawn, opposed the enemy, should stop my way, but by my ruin.
Lay hold upon him, Priam, hold him fast, he is thy crutch. Now, if thou lose thy stay, thou on him leaning, and all Troy on thee, fall all together.
Come, Hector, come, go back. Thy wife hath dreamt, thy mother hath had visions, Cassandra doth foresee, and I myself am like a prophet suddenly enwrapped to tell thee that this day is ominous. Therefore, come back.
Aeneas is a field, and I do stand engaged to many Greeks, even in the faith of valor, to appear this morning to them.
Aye, but thou shalt not go.
But I must not break my faith. You know me, dutiful. Therefore, dear sir, let me not shame respect, but give me leave to take that course by your consent and voice, which you do here forbid me, royal Priam.
Oh, Priam, yield not to him.
Do not, dear father.
Andromache, I'm offended with you. Upon the love you bear me, get you in.
This foolish, dreaming, superstitious girl makes all these portents.
Farewell, dear Hector. Look how thou diest. Look how thy eye turns pale. Look how thy wounds do bleed at many vents.
Hark! How Troy roars, how Hecuba cries out, how poor Andromache shrills her dolorous fault. Behold, distraction, frenzy, and amazement, like witless antics one another meet, and all cry, Hector! Hector's dead! Oh, Hector!
Away! Away!
Farewell. Yes. Soft. Hector, I take my leave. Thou dost thyself and all our Troy deceive.
You're amazed, my liege, at her exclaim. Go in and cheer the town. Wheel forth and fight. Do deeds worth praise, and tell you them at night.
Farewell. The gods with safety stand above thee. They're ready, talk! Proud Diomed, believe, I come to lose my arm or win my sleeve.
My lord.
What now?
You hear, my lord, you hear, here's a letter come from yon poor girl.
Let me read.
A horse and tissic, a rascally horse and tissic, so troubles me. And the foolish fortune of this girl, and what one thing, what another, that I shall leave you one of these days. And I have a rheum in mine eyes, too, and such an ache in my bones that unless a man were cursed, I cannot tell what to think on it. What says she there?
Words, mere words, no matter from the heart. The effect doth operate another way. Go wind to wind, and turn and change together. My love would work an error still she feeds, but edifies another with her deeds. Hence broke her lucky.
Now they are clapper clawing one another. You'll look on. That descending abominable varlet Diomed has got that same scurvy, dopey, foolish young knave sleeve of Troy in his helm there. I would fain see them meet, that same young Troyan ass who loves the whore there might send that freakish whoremasterly villain with the sleeve back to his dissembling luxurious drab of a sleeveless errand. On the t'other side, the policy of those crafty, sweating rascals, that stale old mouse-eaten dry cheese Nesta, that same dog-fox Ulysses has not proved worth a blackberry. They set me up in policy, that mongrel cur Ajax, against that dog of his badder kind, Achilles. And now is the cur Ajax grown prouder than the cur Achilles, and will not arm today. What upon the Grecians begin to proclaim barbarism, and policy falls into an ill opinion. Stop, please.
Why not? For shouldst thou take the river Styx, I would swim up.
Thou dost miscall, retire. I do not fly. But advantageous care with duty from the odds of multitude, have at thee. Hold thy horse, throw in now for thy horse, Grecian. Ha ha, now the sleeve. Now the sleeve.
What art thou, Greek? Art thou of Hector's match? Art thou of blood and honor?
I am a rascal, a scurvy, railing knave, a very filthy rogue.
I do believe thee, live.
Hello, Hector!
Yes,
God of mercy that thou wilt believe me. But a plague break thy neck for frighting me. What's become of the wenching rogues? I think they swallowed one another. I would laugh at that miracle, yet in a sort, lechery eats itself. I'll seek them.
Go, my servant, take down Troilus' horse. Present the fair steed to my lady Cressida. Fellow, commend my service to her beauty. Tell her I've chastised the amorous Troyan and am her knight by proof.
I go,
Renew! Renew! The fierce Polydamas hath beat down men, and bastard Margarellan hath glorious prisoner, and stands Colossus-wise, weaving his beam over the passion courses of the kings, Epistrophus and Cetus. Polixenes is slain, Patroclus, Thanor slain, Amphimachus and Thous deadly hurt. The dreadful Sagittarius appalls our numbers. Haste we die to reinforcement, or we perish all!
Ho! Fair Patroclus, party to Achilles, and bid the snail-pinched Ajax arm for shame. There are 1,000 Hectors in the field. Now here he fights on Galatea his horse, and there lacks work, so anon he's there afoot, and there they fly or die like scaled skulls before the belching whale. Then yonder is he, and there the stroy Greeks, right for his edge, fall down before him like the mower swath. Here, there, and everywhere he leaves or takes, dexterity so obeying appetite that what he wills he does, and does so much that truth is called impossibility.
Oh, courage, courage, princes! The great Achilles is arming, weeping, cursing, vowing vengeance. Patroclus' wounds have roused his drowsy blood, together with his mangled myrmidons that noseless, handless Hector and Chip come to him crying on Hector. Ajax hath lost a friend, and foams at mouth, and he is armed and at it, roaring for Troilus, who hath done today mad and fantastic execution, engaging of and redeeming of himself with such a careless force and forceless care, as if that luck, in very spite of cunning, bade him win all.
Troilus, thou coward, Troilus!
Aye, there!
So we brought together!
Where is this Hector? Come now, boy killer! Show thy face! Know what it is to meet Achilles angry! Where's Hector? I will none but Hector!
Troilus, thou coward! Troilus, shall I hurt?
Where is Troilus?
What wouldst thou?
I would correct him.
For I'm the gentleman, it's a fly over there that correct him.
As I say!
Oh, Diomed! Turn thy false face, thou traitor, and pay thy life. Thou owest me for my horse.
What art thou here?
I'll fight with him alone.
He's my prize, I'll not look on.
Come, both you cogging Greeks. Have it, you both!
Hey, Troilus! Oh, well fought, my youngest brother.
Now I do see thee. Have at me, Hector.
Pause, if thou wilt.
I do disdain thy courtesy, proud Troian. Be happy that mine arms are out of use. My rest and negligence befriend thee now, but thou anon shalt hear of me again. Till when, go seek thy fortune.
Why, fare thee well. I would have been much more a fresher man had I expected thee.
Ajax hath ta'en Aeneas. Shall it be? No, by the flame of yonder glorious heaven, he shall not carry him. I'll be ta'en to or bring him off. Fate, hear me what I say. I reek not though thou in my life today.
Stand, thou Greek. Thou in goodly mark. Oh, wilt thou not? I like thy armor well. I'll crush it and unlock the rivets all, but I'll be master of it.
Wilt thou not cheese to bind? Why then fly on, I'll hunt thee for thy hide.
Come here about me, you my myrmidons. Mark what I say, attend me where I wheel. Strike not a stroke, but keep yourselves in breath. And when I have the bloody Hector found, impale him with your weapons round about. In fellest manner, execute your arms. Follow me, sirs, and my proceedings aye. It is decreed. Hector the Great must die.
Ah, oh, the couples and the couples make them at it. Now, bull, now, dog, low, that is low. Now, my double head is middle. Low, that is low. Whoop, whoop, bull has the game. We're on, though.
Can't save and fight.
What art thou?
Bastard son of Triumph.
I am a bastard, too. I love bastards. I am a bastard begot, a bastard instructed, a bastard in mind, a bastard in valor, in everything, an illegitimate. One bear will not bite another, and wherefore should one bastard take heed? Ooh, take heed. Mortals most ominous to us. What if the son of a whore fight for a whore? He tempts judgment, so farewell, bastard!
The devil take me! Coward!
Most putrefied core, so fare without. Thy goodly armor thus hath cost thy life. Now is my day's work done. I'll take good breath. Rest, sword. Thou hast thy fill of blood and death.
Look, Hector, how the sun begins to set. How ugly night comes breathing at his heels, even with the veil and darking of the sun to close the day up. Hector's life is done.
I'm unarmed. Forgo this vantage, Greek.
Strike, fellow, strike. This is the man I seek. So, William, fall thou. Now, Troy, sink down. Here lies thy heart, thy sinews, and thy bone. On, Myrmidons, cry you all amain. Achilles hath the mighty Hector slain. Hark, a retreat upon our Grecian part.
The Trojan trumpet sounds like, my lord.
The dragon wig of night o'erspreads the earth, and stickler-like the army separates. My half-supped sword, that frankly would have fed, pleased with this dainty bait, thus goes to bed. Tom, tie his body to my horse's tail. Along the field, I will the Trojan trail.
Ah! Ah, what shout is that?
His drums!
Hector! Hector is slain!
The brood is Hector is slain, and by Achilles.
If it be so, yet dragless let it be. Great Hector was as good a man as he.
March patiently along. Let one be sent to pray Achilles at our tent. If in his death the gods have us befriended, great Troy is ours, and our sharp wars are ended.
Stand ho! Yet are we masters of the field. Never go home. Here star we are tonight.
Hector is slain.
Hector's
forbid. He's dead. And let the murderer's horse's tail and beast be sought dragged through the shameful field.
Frown on, you heavens, effect your rage with speed. Sit, gods, upon your thrones and smile at Troy. I say at once, let your brief plagues be mercy and linger not our sure destructions on.
The Lord, you do discomfort all the host.
You understand me not to tell me so. I do not speak of flight, of fear, of death, but dare all imminence that gods and men address their dangers in. Hector is gone. Who shall tell Priam so? And Hecuba? Let him that will a screech owl I be called.
Walk into Troy and say there, Hector dead. Yet at a word will Priam turn to stone, make wells and Niobes of the maids and wives, cold statues of the youth, and in a word, scare Troy out of itself. Walk away. Hector is dead. There is no more to say.
Stay it. You vile, abominable tents, thus proudly pite upon our Phrygian plain. Let Titan rise as early as he dare. I'll coo and
like a wicked conscience still that moldeth goblins swift as frenzy's thoughts.
Strike a free march to Troy with comfort, go! Hope of revenge shall hide our inward woe.
My lord, hear you, hear you.
Hence, broker lackey, ignominy and shame pursue thy life and live I with thy name.
A goodly medicine for mine aching bones.
Oh, world, world, world!
Thus is the poor agent despised. Oh, traitors and bawds, how earnestly are you set to work and how ill requited. Why should our endeavor be so desired and the performance so lulled, huh? What instance for it? What verse for it? Let me see.
Oh, merrily, the humble bee doth sing. Killy hath lost his honey and his sting. And being once subdued in armored tail, sweet honey and sweet notes together fail.
Good trainers in the flesh, set this in your painted gloves. As many as be here of Pandas Hall,
your eyes half out, weep out at Pandas Fall.
Or if you cannot weep, yet give some groans, though not for me, yet for your aching bones.
Brethren and sisters of the hall door trade, some 2 months hence, my will shall here be made.
It should be now, but that my fear is this, some dull-head goose of Winchester would hiss. Till then, I'll sweat
and seek about for eases. And at that time, bequeath you my diseases.